Hello and welcome to a new episode of the Game Informer Show. I'm your host, Ben Hansen, joined by Kyle Hilliard.
Hello.
We got Ben Reeves.
Hello.
And JV Gwaltney.
Hello.
It's an exciting show, you guys. We're really going to do it today, because not only are we talking about our new cover story, Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, which Ben Reeves and Kyle and I have a lot to say about. Sorry we had to be cryptic a couple weeks ago when we talked a little bit about the game, but we are excited to talk all about our extensive time playing it. You'll learn something new, I promise. And then, after that, we're talking to JV about Fire Emblem Heroes. We might hot swap somebody else into the hot seat here who has some strong opinions. After that, we're talking a little bit about the Elder Scrolls Online Morrowind expansion with that mysterious someone. So,
oh, who could that be?
It should be good. And then we have a ton of great emails from the community. And then after that, we are talking to Jason VandenBerghe, who's the creative director for Honor from Ubisoft Montreal.
All right.
It is a fun interview. If you don't remember this guy from E3, he looks like a Viking. He sounds like a Viking. He screams a lot. He's very entertaining.
He has a cane, or at least he had one in E3, which made him look all the more badass.
That's right.
I think he killed me during the PAX sessions when we were playing the game for a preview event. I think he killed me. I think
he seems like the type of guy who would like kill you, and then he would just scream and run over to your console and like push you down in front of it. So talk to him about having that kernel of an idea, which is just visceral combat, right? And then ballooning that out into a full Ubisoft game. What's it like to run a team that has ballooned up to that size? It's a lot about like creative direction and leadership, which I'm super into. He also, when I brought up Bushido Blade as a possible reference, he made this sound.
This is how it feels.
So he's very excited to talk, and we're excited to talk to him because For Honor is going into open beta very soon. I think this weekend, so people can check it out, and it seems like he's eager for people to send in feedback. But for now, Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. If this is your first time watching or listening to the show, thank you for joining us. Tell a friend. So we went to New York for that Switch event. We talked all about it on the podcast a couple weeks ago. What we didn't talk about was that we were shuffled off to a secret room and Kyle got to play several hours of Breath of the Wild. And then the day after that, we got to interview Anuma, who's the producer for Zelda, and Mr. Miyamoto himself. And we've been carving a whole month of coverage out of it. But
that's right.
Kyle, after playing several hours of Breath of the Wild, biggest takeaway. What'd you think?
Biggest takeaway. The biggest takeaway, I think, would be the challenge. The game was harder than I thought it would be. And maybe it's just a matter of like having played previous Zelda games where I've gotten used to how the combat works, but I was getting killed often. I mean, you guys can kind of confirm that. I died a lot just kind of exploring the open world.
Oh, yeah.
I was getting hit by enemies that were taking off like 6 hearts at a time. But even just the fact of how much damage enemies were taking is an indicator to me that they're going to be more difficult in general. Like, enemies don't take you on one at a time, which was a big thing about Ocarina, is that enemies, if you met a group of enemies, they would usually take you on one at a time, but that's not the case here.
You say Ocarina. It's interesting. I'm trying to remember with Skyward Sword, they still kind of wait their Z-targeting turn, right?
I think so. Yeah, I just know it started with Ocarina. Like, they actually referenced watching samurai films and how those fights would break down. That was inspiration for how the combat worked in Ocarina of Time.
Yeah.
We encountered ice Lizalfos, which are like icy lizard sword.
They like hiding in snow.
That's right. And I was fighting one, and then one just like jumped up out of the snow from behind me and killed me instantly and did not wait his turn. You know, he didn't look at me. I was like, well, I'll wait till he finishes that fight and then I'll jump in there. He came in and took off 6 hearts and I was dead.
The demo that we saw, it certainly had a lot more numbers in it than I was expecting. I think there's going to be a lot more of tracking stats and buffs. Like, you can eat different food and it'll make you like your stealth ability is better for a certain period of time, or you can withstand the cold for a certain period of time. The UI is a little bit busier than I expected. I guess people have seen the footage that's out there and they have a good idea of what it's going to look like and whatnot. But on the idea of getting better equipment, that was a huge thing. Like, they are very generous with throwing a bunch of different weapons at you all the time. So the way I thought it was that you had to go into the menu and like find the one with the lowest stats. It's just an attack stat. There's like speed and stats, whatnot, but you can like kind of see.
Those are invisible.
Right, but you can kind of get a rough idea. Yeah. But the only number that they show are the attack stats. And I thought you just had to go through the inventory and kind of drop them out manually.
No, but you can it's all like a part of the D-pad. Like, you can quickly flip through weapons and get rid of them quickly too. Like, you actually do twice as much damage as you normally would by throwing a weapon at an enemy. So it is really encouraging you to get rid of your weaker stuff because you're going to do more damage with it. You can throw it at an enemy, do more damage, and then pick up something else without ever having to pause the game, which is nice.
I'm still worried that the equipment breaks on you, but as Hansen said, like, you're constantly getting new stuff. Like, I don't think you're ever going to be in a shortage for weapons. Every enemy you fight has a weapon that he drops and you can pick up and use.
Mm-hmm.
That might be better. I think it is. It does remind me a little bit of games like Skyrim, but that always has the, like, little Nintendo touch to it.
Where, okay.
For example, there was a lightning storm. This really struck me, and, like, you can get struck by lightning, right?
It started as a rainstorm and then turned into a lightning storm, and I had a sword and a shield equipped, and they started sparking on my back, and the lightning was attracted to me and it struck me.
So it's trying
to
give you
me
a warning that, like, hey, if you have steel in the middle of this lightning storm, you need to get it off your body immediately.
You can take it off and throw it at enemies and they'll get hit by lightning.
Yeah.
But in my playthrough, I was super struck by lightning and I super died immediately.
Just weird systems. This is very much, JV, why it's up, you know, your alley, is it's very much the Far Cry 2 of Legend of Zelda's.
All right. I'm there.
It is systems heavy in a really bizarre way. Just like the lightning, like you mentioned, or just little things, like there'll be a huge snowball rolling down this mountain. And it's like, well, if the enemies happen to be in its path, they'll totally get taken out. You can see their health go down as they go tumbling down the mountain alongside
weird.
It. Just so many weird little interactions. Or one little trick they taught us is you have, like, the stasis ability. So you can, like, it's very Dead Space, right? You can, like, freeze an object. And so you can freeze, like, a bomb or an explosive barrel and then just go up to it and hack it 1,000 times with your sword. And then when the stasis runs off, it'll go launching. Basically like the home run derby thing in Smash Brothers. Just go launching and explode in a huge way. There's so many weird little physics quirks in this game that more so than I've ever seen in any Nintendo game, for sure.
Yeah,
it's clear that they've had a long time to work on the game and they just kept putting stuff into it. There's like, what else can we do? Let's add this.
Yeah, that's what I'm kind of interested about ever since this was revealed, that it's going to be more of an open world giant kind of game. Is, okay, how are they going to retain the Nintendo polish? Because, you know, when I think of Nintendo games, I think of that polish. I think that's where they sell me on it. Like Fire Emblem, Smash Brothers, everything's finely tuned. Everything's fun.
Yeah.
Even stuff that's, you know, might seem generic.
Yeah.
There's like some twist to it. So I'm really curious to see how
this
pans out. I
think
this
is going to have that as well.
Well, we did actually get an email on that exact point from Justin Moore. He says, hey, GI crew, should gamers be tempering their expectations for a flawless Zelda experience? Bethesda is known for huge open world games, and even they can't ship a game where you're not getting stuck in an elevator or glitching through scenery on day one. I know this is Zelda, and I know this is Nintendo, but should the sheer size of this map be a concern? Let's also not forget that the game now has been in development for two systems. I know the GI crew has had some hands-on time, but how much of it was just a slice that Nintendo was wanting to show off? I don't remember any big bugs. It wasn't, you know, Link falling through the world. It seems like the game is, yeah, basically done based on the build we played. Like, did anything stand out to you as a buggy?
I mean, it certainly seems to have that Nintendo polish.
With those many systems interacting, I would imagine there's going to be some funny glitch videos. I mean, it's just a default in the industry these days. But as far as it being like a certain slice of the game, like, it was a certain area of the game, but it was very much a demo and a cover story where it's, hey, we're dropping you off in this pretty harsh environment, go nuts.
Right.
It wasn't like, hey, don't look over there, walk down this path, don't interact with this thing that way. Like, it was very experimental.
Yeah, they kind of let us do whatever we wanted, and like, there was no hiccup, there's no like weird wonky thing going on. Like, I didn't see a bug. I would suspect that fans, if they're worried about it having a lack of polish or being buggy, I don't think it will.
It was supposed to come out. At this point, it's three, four years after its like original intended release window.
Right.
Like, they've spent a lot of time cleaning up that game.
The one thing that you might want to worry about a little bit on that front is we don't know exactly what the Wii U version versus the Switch version is going to look like. Maybe there'll be some hiccup in one or the other. We know that resolution's different. It's what, 720 versus 900 for the resolution?
Yeah.
And Nate Bildorf, who's in the Treehouse team, who gave us the demo and whatnot for this whole thing, we asked him about, like, are there any differences between Wii U and Switch? And he said, well, you know, mileage may vary, was his response. I was like, okay, that could mean a lot of things, or it could mean nothing.
And Onuma, did make a special point to say that the frame rates will be the same.
Just to clarify, because I don't think we stated it earlier, you guys played the Switch version.
We played
correct?
Switch.
We totally did.
Pro controller, if you want to get nitty gritty.
That's true.
Okay.
Which
okay,
we also,
so not the Joy-Cons. Yeah. Just, all right.
I did play with the Joy-Cons separately. For that, you know, the demo that was available at the Switch event where you got to just play the first 20 minutes of the game. I played with the two Joy-Cons and, you know, we've talked about this extensively. I actually had a fine time with those. But for our extended gameplay session, yeah, we were using the Pro Controller.
Okay.
One thing that stood out to me as just being silly and awesome is you were fighting like a giant skeleton creature who kept coming back to life, and you had to like actually kill his, like crush his skull to finish him off. But there's a very medieval moment where the weapon you're using to fight this giant skeleton creature was the giant skeleton creature's arm.
It was, I lopped it off and then picked it up and was using it as a
weapon. That sounds so cool.
Yeah, that's really good.
Yeah.
Hey, I don't think we've driven this home. This game seems super, super cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's... see, all three of you guys are like big Zelda people,
I'm
right?
I'm not really.
Okay, I'm in the same camp. Like, yeah. I played Ocarina. I played the 3DS one that people really liked, and A Link to the Past. And I love all three of those. But the other ones, like Skyward Sword or whatever, I couldn't get through.
Sure. Yeah.
So I've been curious about this one just because it seems like such a different Zelda.
Well,
than...
that's the thing. Is like, I'm a big fan of like the classic Zelda formula, but this is so different from that. I was actually nervous. Like, going into E3, when I saw E3, I was like, man, I really want to love this Zelda because Zelda, but it looks so different. I'm not sure. But then after we got to play it for this event, like, I think a lot of my fears got put to rest.
Okay.
And like, I'm actually really excited for it now.
Yeah, it's bold and cool. And again, this might have just been very much the area they showed us and where they put us in the game and whatnot. But it just made me feel, okay, the Dark Souls comparison's done too much. But it made me think of people like Dan Tack or like Matt Burtz in our office here, where it's like, man, those people that used to love Zelda when they were young and now they like a little more hardcore games, maybe even are into Dark Souls. Like, I cannot imagine them, if the entire game is like what we saw, like being disappointed in this. This just seems like that hardcore freeform Zelda experience that they claim they wanted for so many years.
Mm-hmm.
One thing to point out with what we played, I don't know if we made this clear earlier, like they weren't builds of the game. Like someone from Nintendo played the game and created save files for us to jump into.
Yeah.
So they didn't, when we say slice, it wasn't literally like they took out a portion of the game and gave it to us. From what I understand, they just gave us the full game and let us start from a specific save point.
For sure.
So.
So yeah, playing it and watching it, it made me think, this seems like the best possible strategy for Zelda. If it can pull off what I think it's pulling off, this seems awesome. What can go wrong?
Yeah, it's like a fine balance to strike that you have to do that to like please like fans and people like me who are like,
For
maybe.
Sure.
Yeah.
So I'm a little worried about just the weapon durability thing, about spending a lot of time in your inventory. It seems like a complicated UI systems-wise thing for Nintendo, and they haven't done too much in this vein. So I'm a little worried about there being some annoying hiccups along the way in that front. But again, if this world is actually pulling it off, I think it's going to be amazing.
It seems super dense. There is a lot going on. Like, we were dropped off, I think it was called Serene Stable is where we started. And we just kind of went north for an hour and a half. And there was tons of stuff happening on the way there. Like, the weather changed in ways that Nate, you know, and Nintendo, like, they were surprised when they were watching us. They're like, oh, it started storming. We didn't expect that to happen.
Yeah.
Like,
it's pretty dynamic. And I was...
ran into a moose, for Christ's sake.
Yeah.
Our horse died. I think we all were a little shocked.
Your horses can die! Yeah. We, like, they named it Kyle, the horse that is, to try and be cute. And then Kyle took it into combat. And the second it got taken out, it was like a real aggro falling moment from Shadow of the Colossus. It was like, oh, God! Like,
we were all stunned.
And the horse's corpse is lying there. This is a Zelda game, for Christ's sake.
Then Kyle tried to eat it.
Yeah!
Which is like,
well,
just messed up.
No,
I mean, you can't eat
the
horse.
You cannot eat the horse.
But it really, they should patch that.
It really did surprise. And then, if you run into that situation, if you like head super north and you're not hitting shrines along the way there and your horse dies, like you walk back, I guess.
Well, there are some fast travel points between the shrines.
Yeah, there's fast travel, which is nice.
Yeah, the weapons durability thing, though, that's the thing that's sticking out to me, because I can't recall one game with that system where I was like, this makes my experience better. Like, I can't...
I'm curious how it all flows
together.
Even,
me too. Like, The Witcher 3, like, I get why you do that to help, you know, really put you in the shoes of Geralt as sort of this working man who has to, like, upkeep his supplies and whatnot. But even then, it was still annoying. I can't envision an experience with, like, durability for weapons where I'm going, yep, this is good stuff.
It'll certainly add to variety. I mean, the different weapons that we encountered along the way, it's going to make for a... different experiences of just, hey, I have Link's sword moving forward.
I almost wonder if their approach is kind of like the same thing that Halo sort of takes to its weapons, where it wants you to constantly be picking up things and trying new things.
Totally.
Like, you're going to run out of ammo on this because we want you to start using this. I wonder if that's their goal. I don't know if I like that. Like, yeah. I don't know if I like it in Halo that much, which is kind of a strange line to draw. But
thinking about it in those terms, I'm kind of like, okay, well, I guess I do that in like other types of games. So maybe it's not that bad. It's just you're used to having this one type of thing in Zelda or these kinds of games.
Because even in that play session, what I ended up doing was using my weakest weapons first. Like, oh, that one does a lot of damage. I'm going to just keep that one if I run into something big later.
So, I imagine I'll probably just use my second strongest weapon the whole game. Like, once I finally get something more powerful than that, I'll switch over. But anyway.
And then that calls into question, like, what is the Master Sword in the game? Is it...
They were really cute about that.
Yeah, they said it's like, we asked them about it, and they're like, it's a mystery.
Hey, it's on the cover of Game Informer. Like, it's going to be in the game.
You're
but at what
get
capacity?
It for like the last 10 minutes or something.
It'll be like a gravity gun.
Oh, it'll be the gravity gun. Yeah.
Something. So, Nate Bildorf, again, who's with Treehouse News, guiding us.
Do you
want to
explain who he is? Like, just real quickly, he was.
Oh, yeah. He's the cream dream thrill of a lifetime. He's the guy who wrote Paper Mario or localized Mario, to be
translated,
fair. So, it was fantastic.
Yeah, he was great.
We were sitting out by some food, getting ready to do this demo, and I saw him walk by and I recognized him because I'm a Paper Mario nut. It's like, oh my god, that's the guy that works in the Treehouse.
And you yelled at him about Color Splash for an hour.
I did not. But it immediately was like, oh my god, can I shake your hand, Nate? Oh my god, you wrote Paper Mario. I love those games so much. And then I was like, hey, can we get a picture? He's like, oh, we're going to be spending the rest of the day with you guys as you play Zelda. Like, I'm actually your tour guide in there. I was like, oh my god, okay, great.
That was awesome.
Then you jumped into his arms.
And he carried me away.
Like, you guys went and got married.
Whispered sweet nothings about Rock Hawk along the way from Thousand Year Door. What the hell was, where was I going with that?
I don't remember.
You were just explaining who Nate is.
He said, and he's trained, you know, but we asked him about weapon durability, and he said he did not find, he's played through the game several times at this point. He said, like, there's no ideal path. It's unbelievably freeform, all this stuff that is great to hear. But he said that at no point did he find a weapon that.
An invincible weapon.
That's right.
Our wording that we asked him.
It sounded sincere. It didn't seem like he was cagey trying to talk around the Master Sword. So that adds to my confusion, but maybe he is just really good at his job and it's imperceptible.
Right.
But he did tell us that every weapon can degrade.
So Kyle, how many pots are out there in the wilderness and breadth of?
I didn't see any.
Yeah, I didn't
did
see
you?
Any
does Link go hya?
Believe so. You can cut grass, but it does not reward you anything.
Yeah, there's no hearts. No.
Wow.
Don't get hearts and grass.
Yeah. Wow.
It's diabolical. There's no little cutscene. No da 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 da. When you're opening a chest,
if
that's gone.
If you kick a small chest and you're not wearing shoes, Link will say ouch.
He'll do the cartoon thing where he's hopping.
The animation in that game is stunning. Like just his little movements, because you can go in the pause menu and see how he's reacting to things. And like when he's cold, he's shivering. It's so cool. It's he looks so.
I mean, it looks really good. Yeah. Like just it reminds. Me a little bit of Wind Waker, like how you know, is it cel shaded?
It's like slightly. Yeah.
It's dancing with it. There are like Wind Waker touches, even where when it's cold out and he's breathing heavily, like the breath that comes out of his mouth, the wild stuff itself, it kind of has like this spiral artistic swirl to it, a little bit like a Wind Waker explosion look.
Right.
Yeah, Nintendo's always been good at like just art design, and I think art style really shines, even though visually maybe it doesn't look as polished as. Like The Witcher, let's say.
Yeah.
Like, sure. Well, it doesn't look as photorealistic.
Yeah, photorealistic. But like the art design, art style is so cool that you're like, you don't even care.
Yeah. I felt that way about, for the brief time I owned a Wii U, any Nintendo developed game I had, it might not have like looked amazing technically, but the art style was so good.
Yeah.
It didn't
matter. Color Splash is, you know, controversial as that game is, one of the best looking games I've ever played. I will always argue that. That game is amazing. Jerry wrote in. We got a couple people asking Zelda questions. You guys ready for that?
Yeah.
Good old Jerry wrote in and said, hey, Hanson and crew, the last two Zelda games, Skyward Sword and Link Between Worlds, I think have done the best job presenting the main story. Yet one thing I want in a Zelda game that has not been present so far is meaningful character development side missions, like The Witcher 3 brings up. How do you guys think the storytelling will be affected in Breath of the Wild with the game being open world?
Hmm.
I don't know.
What did we see of the story, Kyle?
Well, even outside of our play session, we've seen Link wake up from like a 100-year nap. We've heard Zelda speak a little bit. We've interacted with a couple characters. The most information that we have to answer that question probably comes from talking with Onuma about how the story is going to unfold in the game.
Right.
And he was very mysterious about it. It's some weird idea that he had apparently 20 years ago when he first started making Zelda that he's been sort of thinking about that he's now integrated into this game. It seems like you can look in the menus and see what appears to be a, like maybe you can fill out with story moments or something like that.
Oh, I didn't see that. Okay.
Yeah, and it looks like maybe you'll like run into people and you'll get side quests or something, but this is all unconfirmed. This is just me speculating.
Well, we didn't really see side quests though.
We didn't. Yeah. I mean, we talked to a character named Sprin, I think, at the stable and whatnot, but it was just a normal Zelda character. It was not voiced. Seems like voiced characters and actors, that's just for the cutscenes. But we didn't see any in, you know, a couple hours of playing in the area that we were. There were certainly moments where we're about to activate a button or do something, and then Nintendo's like, don't, that's off limits for now. So assuming that would have triggered some cutscene.
One small thing is the character, there's a lot of stables around where you can kind of store your horses. The person who runs the stable is a distinct named character. So I think you're not going to see a lot. I don't think characters are going to feel randomized. Cause sometimes you'll just see NPCs that feel kind of random.
Yeah.
We'll see about that because we only saw a couple people, but they all seem distinct and they all seem to have names. And they did say things, you know.
We do have a video coming up soon on the website that's with Miyamoto and Anuma talking about storytelling in Breath of the Wild. So it might answer some of Jerry's questions. But it is just a cagey thing where they say you can go through the game and completely skip the story. Everybody's going to have different bullet points of the story that they get. And somehow it's all going to feel organic is the word they used.
So we're talking about like memento style thing where everything's out of order?
No. I just think it's... I don't know what's going to trigger...
You start the game saving Zelda, and then you go backwards.
I just, certain areas in theory will trigger certain story moments, but it'll make sense even if you only hit a certain fraction of those. That's where it gets confusing. I really want to see. Because it's... I mean, we asked the direct question in the video coming up, but that trailer, I mean, there's like real heavy cutscenes where it's Zelda crying, and combined with the demo that we had, which was so freeform, I don't know how you mash those two together in a way that feels organic.
If they're not going to direct you towards anything on the map, like that does sound really hard to like convey a logical story with flow, unless it's just like, I don't know, it's all told in flashbacks or something. Like you get to a point and then it flashes back.
That's an interesting idea, because since you start the game waking up from a 100-year nap, maybe you see the things that led up to Link going to sleep.
Well, we do know a couple cryptic things about the story that I guess we haven't talked about yet, right? Like, there is some narrator talking to you, including throughout the dungeon, and the narrator made some wing puns and some bird-based puns. So maybe it's just this one dungeon, maybe it's the entire game, you have this narrator working with you, but nowhere to be seen. But there is some sort of VO from this...
While we were playing through the dungeon, someone was talking.
Yeah.
You think that's a callback to Skyward Sword?
I don't know.
I don't know. I mean, there is like a flying bird character in the trailer, and so maybe it's the same one. We're not sure. But then also in the dungeon, which we should probably talk about in a little bit here, there is what they call malice.
Yes.
Right? Which is kind of like some Jabu-Jabu style corruption.
It's like goop. Yeah. Poison that kind of is on the floor. It has little eyeballs coming out of it that you have to shoot with your arrow.
Evil Ganon-y type stuff.
some real gross stuff.
Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, they did say that this takes place after Wind Waker, right?
Is that right? No. They did say Ocarina of Time, which is in our 51 questions for Miyamoto and Eiji Onuma, which you should check out on the website. It's fantastic.
Yeah, if you just listen to the podcast, we posted this rapid-fire video interview with Ben Reeves talking to Miyamoto and Onuma on the website on Wednesday. You can dig it up and find it, but it is an absurdly good time to watch.
Right. But there is, in response to Wind Waker, there are a lot of fan theories going around talking about that they think it takes place after Wind Waker. But nothing official from
Nintendo.
Which
is interesting because Wind Waker is pretty late in the timeline, so to speak. Yeah. So anyway, just an interesting aside for all you timeline nerds.
Yeah.
I'm one of those.
Hey, Kyle.
Hello.
Michael from St. Paul writes in. He says, "Hey, GI crew, in Breath of the Wild, do you have an idea of the balance between traditional dungeons and the smaller shrines? Nintendo has said there will be traditional dungeons, but have said almost nothing beyond that. Are they still as big of a part of the game as previous Zelda games? Why haven't we heard about them?" And before you answer this, wonderful question from Michael from St. Paul. You had an interesting analogy about the shrines. It reminded you of
Batman Arkham Riddler puzzles.
In Arkham Knight.
Yeah. You find...
So please explain.
Yeah. You find shrines everywhere and you go into them and they're basically like, maybe you could say a room or two of a standard dungeon. Like one, you just solve one big puzzle or maybe two big puzzles
to get
through them.
They're little test chambers, yeah.
Yeah, and they reminded me of Riddler puzzles in the sense that they are literally puzzles that are kind of distributed throughout the world, which I'm a big fan of. I really like the idea of them breaking apart little Zelda puzzles and distributing them everywhere. I think that's going to be really cool.
I like that comparison. I will say in like Batman, they're integrated into the world a little bit more, whereas the shrines, you kind of go in and it's separated from the world.
It's a standalone thing.
Although it is a bite-sized puzzle, basically. which is kind of cool because it's like the team just went and made, just go make a bunch of puzzles. And so it doesn't really matter how they fit into the world. Like, we can put it wherever we want. Yeah.
So is it kind of like the Tomb Raider stuff and the newest Tomb Raider where you just find tombs and you go solve them?
It is like that, except like even those tombs are maybe more elaborate than some of these shrines.
There is a little confusion about it, but those are the 100 little shrines. But then there are big classic Zelda dungeons, which we played through one of them.
Yes.
Which and have floors and it's like bigger area and multiple.
But they are smaller, I would say, than recent dungeons. I've been playing Twilight Princess.
The one we played was, at least.
That's true. Yeah, we don't know about the other dungeons, but the one we played felt small compared to a standard Twilight Princess or Skyward Sword dungeon.
Sure.
I mean, it didn't strike me that way. As not the biggest Zelda fan, I didn't leave thinking that was a little short.
It didn't seem like, I mean, it seemed maybe comparable with Ocarina's dungeon size. Would you compare it to that?
Maybe some of the earlier ones, because they get bigger as you go on, but like the first three Ocarina, I mean, like I said, I'm literally playing Twilight Princess now, so maybe I have a better sense of like where I can compare them. It felt smaller. I got through it faster than I can get through a Twilight Princess dungeon.
Still tricky.
Yes. Yeah.
It's still a dungeon though. It still has that feel. It's still like multiple challenging.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't pitch
puzzles
it
and all that stuff.
As
and it was cool.
Yeah, they didn't pitch it as the wind dungeon, but the puzzles were wind based.
Right. Yeah, so you were like closing vents and stuff like that.
Well, it was cool because you could like rotate the whole dungeon and like move it around.
Right.
And so the direction that the dungeon is turned, let's say, affects certain puzzles and stuff. Mm-hmm. And you solve puzzles in different rooms.
It was a funky dungeon, which
is funny to call back just a minute ago. There's actually, remember in Batman Arkham Knight, the what's it called? The dirigible.
Yeah.
You could actually tilt.
Right.
It actually kind of reminded me of that.
This game is basically just a reskin of Batman.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, Jamie, have we made that clear? Have we been doing a bad job?
Man.
It is just Arkham Knight.
Yeah.
We've been trying to tell you.
This is the story of how Link dies then.
That's right.
We did ask Onuma about the dungeons, and he said that they were kind of intentionally less complicated because they're sort of offloading the puzzles, it seems, to those shrines. So you're still going to get the same amount. It seems probably more puzzle that you would in a Zelda game thanks to the shrines. But the dungeon we played it just felt like a little smaller to me.
Yeah.
I
will say, as like, dungeons were always my favorite part of a Zelda game. And so when we saw this dungeon, I was a little bit relieved. I'm like, finally, you get to see like these things are actually in the game. And I was happy to see it. Even though, like you're saying, it's smaller. Like,
it was still a lot of fun. Yeah, I don't want to diminish it.
It's a lot of fun.
It was cool.
The dungeon we saw was one of the coolest parts of our demo.
Yes, it's nice that Zelda is hiding the dungeon aspect, I think, to some extent, because as we learned with the cover reveal, people are very sensitive to spoilers. Like, you say the name of the boss at the end of the dungeon. It's not the final boss, not the final dungeon, but seemed like there was a strong community on the internet that considered a screenshot of that boss, even the name of that boss, to be a spoiler.
Yeah, and I think that's fair. I guess I thought that we played a lot of Zelda. We played more of Zelda than anyone outside of Nintendo at this point, and I still don't think we've seen very much of that game overall.
For sure.
So that, I'm absolutely sensitive to spoilers myself. I get that complaint, but just know that that was a very small part of Breath of the Wild.
I don't think it's as big of a deal as maybe some people think it might be.
I think so too.
Yeah, that's
like
the
when
other
you
thing.
Actually
yeah.
see that in a game, you'll be like, okay, I didn't think that. I thought it was more than that.
Yeah. But one other quick thing on the dungeon front too is Mr. Bildorf giving us a demo and whatnot. He framed an interesting way where he said, like, you'll have a lot of responsibility in this game. Like, if you need an item and you go into this dungeon and you run out of those items in your inventory, there's not going to be a machine popping out an infinite amount of those items next to you. Like, you need to go back to the world map, make sure you're fully stocked up, make sure you're fully ready to go. And that also carries over to, like, fighting the guardians, right?
Yeah.
Which are huge robotic creatures, well, large robotic creatures, that seem unbelievably tough. And it's just like, hey, you need to be stocked up and ready to go to take these guys
on. That's the one that smashed you to pieces, right?
Oh, yeah,
Kyle.
Big time. That was the one where I was like, I want to keep playing. I don't want to stop playing Zelda. And they were like, look, you're not going to beat this thing. Please give us the controller back. And I was like, no, I don't want to leave. I just want to move in here and keep playing Zelda, please.
And then you tried to run out the door with the Switch.
Yeah, Nate was mad about that.
We should point out that on that Switch where we're playing Zelda, we tried pressing every button on the controller.
That's right.
To like bring up UI or anything.
Yeah, the screenshot button, the menu button. I tried to first thing I did was try to press all those buttons.
Eventually, you're trying to play Zelda with the screenshot button. Oh, is this the arrow button here? What's going on?
Oh, what do I do?
So Don Heikert from St. Louis Park, Minnesota writes in. He says, hey, Ben and Game Former crew. Hello. How's the soundtrack for Breath of the Wild and the sounds of the game? Is the music up to snuff? Also, how are the environmental sounds? Can you hear critters, bugs, wind, etc.? All those sounds really make a difference in pulling a player into the world. Thanks again for such a great show each week. Thank you. What did you guys think of the soundtrack?
It didn't stand out to me a ton, for better or worse. I think maybe it's intentionally quiet to represent a natural world, but
it's subdued.
I will say the sound effects in the world seemed good.
Yeah.
You know, there's part of mechanic where like you can sneak through enemy bases, you can sneak up on enemies. So when you're doing that, you kind of hear the wind, you hear yourself like walking up, sneaking out on them. The music though, it didn't, I'm sure it'll be good, but it wasn't something that I took note of. Yeah.
So they were cagey when we asked about the composers for this game. The internet, and I don't know at what point it came out, but the internet certainly seems locked that it's this person named Manaka Katowaka. I'm sorry, I probably butchered that.
Waka waka. But
they actually composed. They composed.
You guys should see this look that JV gave me. It's the sweetest, kindest.
But they helped compose Spirit Tracks, the overworld theme in Spirit Tracks, wildly underrated for Zelda songs.
I like the music in Spirit Tracks.
Also, Animal Crossing New Leaf, which has a fine soundtrack.
That's a good soundtrack.
So the main theme for Breath of the Wild, it has a very Ghibli vibe to it. Did you
the whole
well,
game
Kyle?
Does.
That's
it
really because like the visuals remind me of Ghibli as well.
Yeah, actually,
they've always drawn on Ghibli for sure.
Let's listen to a little bit of that main theme here. So it goes on and builds from there. I'm sure you've heard that cue
a
lot.
Right. That was just music from Spirited Away, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's just the full Spirited Away soundtrack.
It's the piano work. That's what it is, right?
Yeah.
The most striking music that I heard a lot during our time playing is just...
You were playing that nonstop during the interviews.
I was so bored.
Oh,
Miyamoto,
my gosh.
Ba-beep, ba-beep, ba-beep.
Have you heard of Kid Rock?
Oh, Skull Kid Rock? But... there's this weird piano music that plays when you're just kind of exploring the world.
Yeah.
And Wade in the booth, you want to pipe that in here? It's just exploration. Should be the second track here. This is obviously a horse that you're manning. It's from gameplay, but just listen to the piano in the back.
Jamie,
nothing funny about it.
This sounds lewd.
Anyways, just bizarre, random kind of chirps from a piano, but it was very present.
I like it. It kind of makes me
really
It makes me think of the word digital comes to mind. It seems like there's like this electronic, almost science fiction-y undertone to the whole game, and like that theme. I remember seeing that approaching the guardian and seeing that guardian walking around and hearing the little tinkling on the piano. It just makes it's kind of electronic.
Yeah.
It just there's something digital about.
Sure.
This game that I don't know what it
is yet.
There's
a certain sci-fi-ness more so than any Zelda.
You're carrying around an iPad, pretty much. Like it's so
right,
I'm curious to see, because they went a little science fiction-y later in Skyward Sword, and I really liked it.
Yeah.
And I would like to see them, because the original idea for Zelda was that like Link goes into a computer. That was like the original idea. Yeah, and like you're like dealing with computer chips and stuff like that. Like dungeons were like going into computers, but they changed that to be like more like fantasy. So I wonder if that's kind of like Miyamoto sort of finally looping around to maybe kind of play with that idea a little bit.
It's
like
a little bit of that Star Wars strategy of like using some of George Lucas's ideas from 1975 now.
And I mean, there's the very first reveal for it. Link had that like weird lightsaber thing, and we encountered a guardian that dropped a spear that was tipped with that electronic thing. So I'm really curious to learn more about what that is.
Yeah. You guys want to hear one more track from the game?
Yeah.
So this is around Serene Stable, which is an area that only we've seen. We have some footage of coming up soon on the site and whatnot. But here's the music when you're walking up to the stable, just for a nice palate cleanser here. Some good, peaceful, classic-sounding Zelda. And you're talking to this lovely guy, what the UI sound is.
Aww.
And there's some good old Zelda sounds.
This reminds me of the Twilight Princess a little bit.
Yeah, I can see that.
And
like Kakariko Village and stuff. Yeah. I love that little Zelda, because it just gives a little bit of character without having to give them a full voice.
I want to see like how big a sound library is for the NPCs. Like just how many grunts and random sounds there are.
Just like, who does the Zelda voice, and what was that recording session like?
It was the actual Zelda voice.
Or I meant Link.
Oh, yeah.
But the Zelda one would be interesting too, because she actually has real dialogue.
Yeah, and there was not a hint of Zelda in the extended demo.
We talked to him about Zelda a little bit,
yeah.
Which, like, you know, you'll see in our cover story. But as far as our playtime, we didn't see her, didn't interact with her in any way.
Yeah. Overall, I came out of that thing like, man, I cannot wait. And I just love this bold new approach for Zelda. And there has to be a downside, and I'm not certain what it is yet, but I think that's just the pessimist in me looking at this, because like, this seems like what people have been asking for a long time.
Like me and Reeves, I think, are both big, like, old school Zelda fans. Like, we like big dungeons and stuff like that. I'd worry about just my personal, like, I wish I could spend more time in dungeons or something like that. But
yeah,
man, we'll see.
I'm worried if, like we said earlier, if the story is going to string together well. I'm worried about the combat a little bit with the weapons and breakable weapons. But
sure.
I mean, everything else, like, sounds so good. It's a beautiful looking game, obviously, and it seems fun to explore that world. Yeah. So, you know what? I'm in.
I can't
sure.
wait.
I had problems with Skyward Sword too, but I still had fun with it. So it looks more promising than that game to me.
I am way more excited about this than I was Skyward Sword, for sure. Like, this is like, I would say Twilight Princess is probably the one that I was anticipating the most. And this is like up there with that. Like, I cannot wait to play more of this game.
So Kyle, with The Legend of Zelda, Breath of the Wild cover story, it was your first time meeting Mr. Miyamoto himself.
That's right, yeah.
What was it like? I mean, not to... Oshana Numa, also him.
I've met Onuma a couple times. I've spoken with him on the phone, and I did sit down and talk to him. I didn't talk to Miyamoto very much. I was nervous, and I didn't want to like interject myself. Like, I didn't want to be like, "Hello, I'm Kyle." Like, I waited until the end when we were splitting off to finally shake his hand and, you know, say hello. I wouldn't be here without the games that you made. You changed my life. Thank you very much.
Let me
give him a little kiss on the cheek and then call it a day. But it was cool. It was a life.
It is just a weird, exciting time when you're in the same room as Miyamoto, because the second he walks in, it's like, I want to ask 1,000 questions. Like, I have so many things. Yeah. Just check off the list. Just fill my brain with your knowledge, sir. But it's like, just be cool. Let him sit down. Let him relax. You don't need a constant rapid fire interview going on. We save that for when we're actually filming it, which he was an unbelievably good sport with.
Just the best.
Him and Anuma.
Super nice.
They actually felt bad at the end of it, I got the impression, because they're like, sorry we weren't funnier. Like, we're trying really hard to be funny. It's like, are you kidding me? Like, we don't need a, you know, clown show from you two. Yeah. You're legends. Like, just sit back. It was hilarious.
Yeah, they killed it too.
Yeah, like, for sure.
Just like the Twitter response and on Facebook and stuff. People were dying. It's just great.
They understand memes.
It was certainly. It was nice to sit. I mean, that's all you and Reeves and Hansen put that. But it was fun for me to sit there and try to stifle my laughter as best I could.
Yeah,
it is funny too. And just to get into it and pat our own backs. But like when the PR people are laughing at something you're doing, that's always kind of feels kind of good.
Yeah, instead of just shaking their
heads. Instead
of
just like shaking their heads and be like, oh my gosh, how are we going to kill this?
So Anuma in interviews has certainly said that, like, hey, Miyamoto has given me more free reign with Breath of the Wild than he ever has. I don't know if you guys read this article recently in Time about kind of the shifting power within Nintendo. Nothing direct, but certainly got the vibe on this trip that, like, Miyamoto he's really starting to step down at Nintendo and from the overall day-to-day operations of the Zelda franchise and of the main franchises.
Right.
It seems like a real
by
turning
choice,
point.
To me, at least that's my perception.
Guy's getting up there.
I don't think anyone's like, Miyamoto, you need to go sit in the rafters.
I don't think so either.
I think he's ready to elevate the people that he's been working with for years. And
certainly. Yeah. Saying one foot out the door is too much, but it felt nice to, you know, shoot some silly interviews with them and some serious interviews, which are going to be going live soon, including one about, which I'm really excited about, at the end of the month. It's about, like, training up the next generation of Nintendo development talent.
Ooh.
I think that's the most insightful interview that we shot. But it certainly felt like he's starting to wave goodbye, not mentally or physically.
He's still making games.
No, yes, absolutely.
Still seemed as spry as ever.
There was a silly moment where it was the night before the Switch reveal. We're in the hotel where the whole Switch event was going on and whatnot. And I was in the elevator by myself, and the elevator doors open, and I see a gray-haired man standing out there, and I realize, oh, that's Anuma. He's standing right there. My God. And then I'm like, oh, he's not getting in the elevator. And then just that second, an arm swung around, and it was Miyamoto starting to walk into the elevator, and the doors were, like, closing at this point. I would have lost my arm. I dove in for those doors so much. I'm like, don't you dare close on me. And then Miyamoto got in, and it was Miyamoto and I going on a quiet elevator ride, like the night before the full Switch hands-on. It's like, magical. So,
and then he noticed you peed your pants, and he was like, "Oh my gosh, this is super embarrassing."
So I just gave him like the most generic English things because he can speak a little bit, right? So I gave him like the excited, hey, big day, excited. And he said, "Yes, but I'm very tired." And he was super shy and just looked down at his feet and was probably like, "Get me out of this elevator." Yeah.
My Miyamoto elevator story is that I was in a crowded elevator with an older couple, and one of them was holding a cup of coffee, and Miyamoto and Onuma got in the elevator, and I was like, oh, it's those guys. And I think it was Miyamoto like was backing the elevator, and the woman spilled her coffee. And I was like, do you know you've spilled your coffee on Shigeru Miyamoto?
Wait, she spilled it all over his face?
No, just like a little bit on the floor that I think spattered onto his leg.
Good story, Kyle.
Oh, it's great.
Classic Hilliard one-upper.
Tell us that again?
Yeah, oh so I was, God. Okay, get that. I'm in the elevator.
No, so yeah, stay tuned. We have a hub on the site, and we're running stories almost every day, eventually Monday, Wednesday, Friday, with new updates on Zelda, and there's a lot of fun stuff throughout the month, so I'm excited about that. That's enough about Zelda, you guys. Hey, Ben
Never
Reeves,
enough.
I think you should give yourself a hand, because you did a really good job talking about Zelda.
Wait, what does this mean? No!
All right. If you didn't know podcast lore, that clap meant that Dan Tack is now joining us, and Ben Reeves vacated himself from the premises.
He vacated himself.
Yeah, all over the floor on the way out the door. But Dan Tack, it's an honor to have you, sir.
Hey, it's great to be here today.
We're here to talk about Fire Emblem Heroes.
Woo!
The free-to-play Fire Emblem game, Nintendo's kind of, sort of, third mobile game. Is that fair to say?
Well, if we're talking about
second
that,
and a
I'm
half.
Just going to leave.
You're talking about the Pokemon trading card game app.
I'm not talking about that. But Fire Emblem Heroes, right? Yep. I really don't know what you guys think about it. I've heard a lot of buzz on the internet that say this is a really generous free-to-play game. I've heard a lot of buzz saying this is
Where did
Fire
you hear
Emblem
that?
For babies. What's the read here? You guys have all been playing it.
Well, Javi reviewed it. So
yeah, I reviewed
let's
it.
Let's have him set the table.
Let's hit him first.
Yeah. Oh, man. I think I'm one of the biggest Fire Emblem fans in the office.
Okay.
Yeah. I know Kim plays it. Tack, you play it.
I do.
Yeah. I love the series. And I was skeptical about how it would translate to mobile. And
hang on. I'm sorry, Javi. We're going to have to stop because Dan Tack's trying to be the funniest MF-er. And if you only listen to the audio version of this show, just imagine that Dan Tack basically put a clown nose on his face and is honking it while staring into the camera lens. And then he actually has a sign, which is kind of like a clock on a chain around his neck. And it says, meme me, please. Meme me.
What's happening here.
Okay, sorry,
please
Javi,
make
go
a
on.
GIF of this.
Yeah, okay,
hold on,
go
I'm
on.
I'm stunned
Javi.
Right now. I need a second.
Let's inform the listeners, JV. What do we got?
All right, I'm back.
You're the biggest fan in the office.
Yeah, yeah. I love Fire Emblem. I was skeptical about how it would translate to mobile, and I think they did a pretty decent job of it, but there are some... Like, it plays like a streamlined, very easy version of the Fire Emblem games, because the main series Fire Emblem games, they can take up to like 30 minutes to maybe an hour in the harder matches.
Yeah.
Just because you have so many units, there are different strategies, there's terrain you have to take into account. But they've really, for the mobile version, the games are lightning fast. Like, they usually don't last longer than 5 minutes. It's a very fan servicey game. It sort of operates on this idea of, it's a gacha game, so there's a booster pack sort of mentality to it where you do battles and you earn orbs, and then you can summon heroes to your army, and it's a random hero every time. And initially, that's exciting, especially as the game, you're playing the game early on, but as the game goes on, that's sort of like the loot box thing from Overwatch. You can get duplicates, and that's infuriating because you can spend like an hour like just farming orbs, and then, well, I already have this unit. This sucks.
We don't like Ike.
Yeah. poor Ike. But there's also a stamina bar, and that's really the big issue for me.
What?
Yeah, you battles cost stamina points. Early on, it's like 2 points. Later on, it's like 5. And I think, Tack, do you remember what like...
It's around like 15.
Yeah, it gets pretty brutal.
So that's just kind of like an energy meter.
Yeah, it's an energy meter, basically. And takes 5 minutes for a single point to regenerate. And so it's very easy for you to run your bar down and then not be able to play the game for a good bit unless, A, you have stamina potion, which you're gifted those as like weekly login bonuses or, you know, daily login bonuses, or you're willing to give up a single orb to regenerate the bar, but you use that orb for everything. That's the game's universal currency. So what Heroes is trying to strong arm you into doing is paying real money for orbs. So
interesting.
Yeah.
So it seems like this is made for people that really like the strategy a Fire Emblem.
Right.
Don't want a narrative heavy experience, can tolerate some, you know, free to play stuff, and just want a streamlined version of Fire Emblem on the go.
Yeah, that's basically it. And it works as that, but to me, there are some elements, and I understand why those elements are missing from Fire Emblem that make Fire Emblem Fire Emblem that aren't there. Like, obviously, there's a lack of a permadeath option. And I know why that is because, you know, people don't want to spend so much time earning a character or paying hard cash for a character only for them to disappear.
Totally get it.
But, you know, it would be nice if there was some compromise there somehow. Like, okay, your character died in battle. You can't use them for a good bit. Or just like a toggle, you know, a toggle for that.
Right.
You know, just so people who are really into that permadeath thing can have that,
yeah,
and it won't affect other players. And there's also the lack of the relationship stuff. Awakening and Fates, part of what made the series popular again, because Awakening was supposed to be the last Fire Emblem.
Really? I didn't know that.
It has a kind of Final Fantasy story to it where, okay, this is our swan song, but the relationship mechanic where in Awakening and in Fates you can marry characters together, and it's not, and most characters can be paired off with each other. Like you can't do combinations for every single character, obviously, but, and these games are huge. We're talking about like up to 50 characters in an army usually that for each game, not on the battlefield, but just, you know, in your roster, and you can pair most of them together. But it's kind of disappointing that you can't do that in this game. Like, you can't pair them off. You can't have them flirt with each other or anything like that.
No relationship stuff.
No relationship stuff. Like, it's weird because you can go into their, like, profile on the game and look at an illustration of them and poke them, and they'll say, like, horny things, like, very sultry things, but you can't actually have them interact with each other outside of the battlefield.
They call them little horny nothings,
yeah,
I think.
Yes.
So, Dan, what is your read on this game as a free-to-play game?
I would say that it is an awful game at
Holy
best.
Holy Lord!
At best. That's at its best. And at its worst, it's a psychologically manipulative, awful, exploitative...
Compared to Fire Emblem games or compared to the average strategy game that's available on mobile?
Compared to anything. I mean, a lot of mobile games are guilty of the same practices, so it's not just this game. But it's more remarkable, I think, when you take a series like Fire Emblem that is really rich in strategy and story and character development and all these things, and you just distill it down to a gambling box that preys upon gambling addiction.
This sounds like Final Fantasy All the Bravest. I mean, that is what I consider the worst of, like, gambling box.
That is the worst thing.
Final Fantasy All the Bravest is
obviously the worst thing. This is obviously not...
It's obviously the worst thing to ever happen in the Final Fantasy series.
It is obviously not that bad, because nothing could be as bad as All the Bravest. That's like the lowest bar possible, right?
Sure. I'd argue the way you're dressed is the lowest bar possible, but go on.
We like to go lower. They go high, we go lower. All right? But yes, it's terrible. It's absolutely terrible. You need 5-star heroes to compete, and they are very rare. I think 3% drop rate or something like that. And you will have to more or less pay to get the best team. You know, it's theoretically possible to get it without that, but not really.
Hang on. Okay,
let me get this. This is like one of the worst offenders, because there are special animations and videos that play when you land one of these 5-star heroes that don't play otherwise. It's really trying to get in your mind and psychologically associate good things happening with making purchases. It's the worst
thing. You can get 5-star heroes just randomly. Kyle, you're making a face. That just seems like acknowledging that these are cool things in the game.
Yeah. I've played about like half the game. I know Dan's big issue with this game, and Dan, you can go into this more, is like the end game is where you're kind of like getting frustrated with it, right?
I mean, I'm not frustrated with it. It's just a terrible game.
Yeah. Well, but you're upset how much it costs to keep playing at this higher level. You've beaten the game at this point, but you're still playing and collecting new heroes, right?
You can't really beat the game, but yeah.
Well,
I've beaten the normal mode campaign.
It's very short. Right. It's 9 chapters.
Because that's the part that, as some, you know, we say this is like Fire Emblem for babies.
Yeah.
Like, I'm that baby. I don't really like Fire Emblem. It takes too long.
It's just not Fire Emblem. It's just a stupid mobile game.
Okay, it's a stupid mobile strategy game.
Jamie, will you stand up for this game?
Yeah.
They're throwing a Fire Emblem skin on an exploitative gacha
machine.
But
it still plays like Fire Emblem.
The strategy,
Emblem.
Yeah. I'm enjoying
the strategy. Plays like a very streamlined lightning version of Fire Emblem. It's a good entryway for someone who wants to go, okay, so this is what, while I'll be playing, if I were to, you know, pick up a main entry Fire Emblem in the series, this is what I'd be doing most of the time. You know, just longer versions of this. And I feel like that's fair. And, you know, one of the reasons I'm not in love with this game, I think I gave it either a 7 or 7.25.
Better than the worst thing that's ever happened to your phone.
Right. But part of the reason I really like it is, or not really like it, but the I appreciate it is there's a meaty campaign.
Yeah.
Yeah, like 9 chapters. It took me a good bit to get through that.
And like, there is like an actual story.
There's nothing to
through.
It. There's not a story.
I mean, it's
Come
not
on.
A good story, there's but no it's a story.
Exists. But that's the part I'm enjoying. Like, I don't see myself playing past the campaign.
Yeah, like I hit a wall at like 10 hours.
And it's that weird thing. I'm not in the market for a game that I'm playing infinitely. I'm in the market for like something I can play for a while and then put down.
Yeah,
I,
and I, if I, you I, look yeah. at it, like what Nintendo has offered mobile-wise so far, you have Pokemon Go, which yeah. is... you know, kind of been broken a good bit. Yeah. You have
and not
super,
really Nintendo.
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, it's their foray into the market.
Sure.
You know, the mobile market. You have, you know, what is it, Super Mario Run?
Yeah.
Which
yeah.
you have to pay money for. Like, you know, you said it's not great. It's not bad.
I do like that model, though.
Yeah.
$10, you have the whole game. That's
the
it.
Internet didn't. Yeah. Investors didn't.
They're wrong.
But
okay.
they're not wrong.
And then, you know, you have Fire Emblem Fates, which... I mean, not Fire Emblem Fates. You have Fire Emblem Heroes, which you can play that whole campaign without having to spend a dime. Like, that's pretty cool.
Like, you came into the office.
The campaign's no good. I'm okay with it being, like you said, a closed circuit experience that has an end. That's fine.
Yeah.
That's not. I don't have a problem with it doing that. It's just simply not a good game.
So it seemed like the presentation was solid. Just a little bit I played. Like, I think the art held up. I think it's well designed for phones. And then, JV, like, the first day after it came out, you came into the office. You're like, yeah, I played 5 hours of it. I haven't paid anything.
Yeah.
It seems solid so far. Like, I understand everyone has different expectations of phone games, but... At least 5 hours for sure, then, because that's the last time I check in with you on this thing.
Yeah, I played 10 hours altogether, and after that's where I hit the wall, where I was just grinding for stuff.
For a free boiled
down
fire.
Yeah. That's,
come
I mean,
on.
No, I'm not complaining. I think that's great. I think that's really, really good. But, you know, as a fan of the series, there are still bits that disappoint me.
For
but
sure.
It's not, I do not think it is a bad game. I enjoyed my time with it.
Dan, is it just like the completionist, more hardcore edge of you that's upset
no.
that you can't do the endgame stuff while still...
No, it's just that basically I've had enough of these psychologically manipulative practices that are being pushed on mobile
How games. Would you do it, realistically, still expecting to make a little bit of money? Because it's doing well.
Hey, I'm not saying you can't make money, but this is something that will be regulated at some point in time. And it's basically the mobile market is like the Wild West that just hasn't come down on yet that people... That they allow these practices to continue.
Just the basic gotcha practices of,
yeah.
hey, put money in here and then we'll give you something.
Put money in, get the best units, become addicted to beating other people with the power of those units.
There's just no way to do that morally.
I'm sure there's a way to do it.
I wonder if one of the reasons I'm like less upset by that aspect of the game is because I mean, this might even be embarrassing to admit. This is like my first like Fire Emblem that I've really gotten into and I'm enjoying the sort of simplified quick strategy. Right. I don't care about collecting those new characters. They don't mean anything to
right,
me.
Right, because, you know,
like
you're not attached to the lore.
I've used all my orbs to, like, increase the experience that I get, and yep. I'm enjoying kind of going back through and just leveling them up through the earlier levels.
Right.
And I wonder if it's just, maybe I just don't really get into that sort of random grab bag stuff. Like, it doesn't really do a lot for me. Maybe I'm lucky in that way that I don't, mm-hmm. that it's not going to get its hooks into me for that reason.
Well, it's not getting its hooks in you because the game just simply isn't that compelling.
Okay.
So that's good. Like, I mean,
it does give me hope seeing how fully featured it was. When they just said it, like, hey, we're making a Fire Emblem for mobile, who knows what the hell that could actually be.
Right.
And the same time they announced that they're making an Animal Crossing for mobile. And so seeing how fully featured this game is, as successful or not, as Dan Tech would argue, it makes me optimistic for the Animal Crossing because they delayed it as well recently or announced it was coming out at a later date at least. And that has me really excited to think that like this could be a streamlined but theoretically full Animal Crossing game.
I mean, I didn't say it wasn't successful. It's making money hand over fist.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Successful by objectively. I'm just
sure.
saying it's terrible.
I do wish the thing that would keep me playing is if there was a full... like the buy it now option that Kyle talked about with Super Mario Run. If I could drop $14 to $20 and just get rid of that stamina bar, just
yeah.
have this game on my phone all the time and just play it over and over again.
Man, I wish it had
that. I that would have made a huge difference in like how I scored it, how much like
sure.
my entertainment value was.
Like Mario Run, like I really do like the model for Mario Run of just you know, $10, you get the full game.
Yeah.
And they also did it for Pokemon Picross, which is a really cool game for DS. Like it was, the price was way too high. It cost $30,
mm-hmm.
but once you hit that $30 mark, like all the sort of you have to wait to play this stuff disappeared. And I feel like they're getting away from that, which kind of sucks because
yeah.
I like that it's an option.
I wonder how much they're going to experiment with free to play stuff for the Switch.
I don't know.
Since they, gosh, as far as I know, haven't really done it much on Wii U. They must see it as more of a handheld mobile type of thing. But now that the Switch is theoretically handheld mobile as well, right? Like, I've got to wonder if
you can't get on the wireless network with it. You can get on Wi-Fi, but you can't get on like the 3G and 4G networks.
Right, but much like a 3DS. I mean, they still experiment with Steel Diver and Rusty's Real Deal Baseball. I just wonder if we'll see those types of experiments going on. Danny, you're shaking your head at the classic dog, Rusty's Real Deal Baseball.
Rusty's Real Deal Baseball is sick.
It's an amazing piece in Nintendo history. I really think it's amazing.
I love how you can negotiate real money on that game. Like,
with
that is
this
crazy.
Sad, divorced dog that's going to kill himself.
Dan hates it.
It's amazing.
It reminds him too much of himself.
Yeah, it does.
Oh, lordy. Hey, Dan Tack.
Got all those pups you got to take care of, Dan.
Man, this is a heck of a podcast.
I need something
to be fair, you walked in dressed like a clown.
I didn't walk in dressed like a clown.
I see. Great point. But you recently went to Maryland.
I did.
To ZeniMax Online. Is that the name of the official studio?
Yes.
To check out Elder Scrolls Online and the big expansion for Morrowind.
That's the thing that happened.
We teased it a little bit on last week's episode. What was your impression visiting the studio, checking out the game, talking to those guys?
Well, it's not a game I've kept up with a lot since launch. That was pretty much my last experience with it. I hear it's amazing now with the one Tamriel update and the other updates they've been doing to the game. And this expansion certainly seems very meaty, like huge. Lots of stuff. 30 hours of story.
Really?
A new trial, which is the raid. New dungeons. New class. Like, you're getting all the expansion bells and whistles here. And I think more importantly than that, for fans of the Elder Scrolls, like, especially, this is Morrowind. This is the Elder Scrolls 3. The world of it. Meticulously recreated for this.
I feel like how much more can they ring those Morrowind fans? I feel like they already did it when the game launched about, hey, you can go back to Morrowind. So it's so weird to have like round two. Now we really mean it. Look at this again.
This is the real Morrowind, right? This is Vardenfell and the Red Mountain and all that crazy stuff. Vivid City. Like, it's all there. Clockwork City even is the new raid. So people are really going to love that.
Let's just get down to it. Did it make you optimistic or excited about the future of Elder Scrolls Online?
I think the Elder Scrolls Online is in a really unique spot in MMOs right now because it is basically the console MMORPG. I mean, I know you can play Final Fantasy XIV and some other stuff on that too, but
DCUO.
It's whatever. no one's playing that. So this is the console MMO more or less. It really is great on console. That's how the game took off. Like, it had a very pretty lukewarm PC launch at the beginning. And then it came to console. People were like, this is really sweet. This is cool. I can play this like a single-player game. I don't have to engage with the MMO elements. I can play this like, Skyrim 2.0. And a lot of people are doing exactly that.
So on console, pardon my ignorance, is it free?
No.
Is it free to play on
PC? It is a buy-to-play game. There is no subscription.
What?
That term is absurd, by the way.
Okay.
Buy to play.
It's stupid.
Wait, so it just means you buy a game once and play it.
Well, because it used to be a subscription fee game, and it's not anymore. Now you just buy the box, and you play forever.
So, in theory, you can buy ESO off the shelf, pop it in your Xbox One, PS4, and just play it that way.
You got it.
Now, so when you're talking about people playing it like a single-player game,
mm-hmm.
because I the idea of going back to Morrowind makes me excited because I loved that game when it came out.
So you'll be playing in Morrowind 700 years prior to the events of The Elder Scrolls 3.
Everything you've always wanted, Jamie.
Oh, sexy. But can you actually play it like offline and by yourself?
Well, you can't play it offline.
But
you can absolutely play it by yourself. And you can start in Vardenfell. You don't have to engage with any of the rest of the game. You could actually start on the shores, just like you do in The Elder Scrolls 3.
More importantly, soundtrack, are they incorporating more of the original soundtrack from Morrowind in there?
I don't have any knowledge about that.
Okay. All right, so it seems like a bold move. Seems cool.
It is. It seems super cool. Like, they do a quarterly DLC, basically, right?
Yeah.
So that's not going to stop, but, like, they want to do these much larger expansions from time to time as well.
It's interesting. So was that their message as well, being at the studio, is, like, kind of rocky launch, consoles are
home?
That's not just the outsider perspective.
That's not just outsider perspective. That was pretty much explicitly stated.
Wow, and they're still going strong over there.
Yeah.
Wow. Cool. Good for them.
I mean, with that kind of game, though, I feel like you have to be in for the long haul, especially if there's a rocky launch, you have to be like, all right, we've got to keep revising this until, because it's a living game.
With a monster like that, right? Like, right. You can't just say, well, it didn't really do that great. Let's quit. It's like, you can't do that with a giant MMO like that, with one of the biggest IPs out there, right? You just can't just say, hey, we gave it a shot. That's just not going to happen.
Right. This isn't quite the full reboot, but it's impressive.
But I do feel like it's very strange. I feel like I hear about that one much more, and maybe it is the console element than I do the Star Wars one.
It's because
the Old Republic.
This one has really righted the ship, for sure. Like, they took away all the stuff that people didn't like, and they started fixing the game more. I mean, just to put it bluntly.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, you can actually play the game like Skyrim now. You couldn't do that before. It was all, like, level-based and everything. Now you can It's just like Skyrim, right? The guys are the same level as you, so everything's scaling with you. You could do whatever, whenever you want.
Yeah. I'm with you though, JB. It definitely seems like... I know not Galaxies.
Old Republic.
Thank you. Old Republic. I know they've done a lot of work. I've seen Gamsutra articles about how they've revamped basically every system in that game and the free-to-play thing changed it completely and whatnot. But I think coming out on consoles is a surprisingly big boost. Right. I understand Old Republic is successful now in its free-to-play state and whatnot, but I just don't think it had the wider splash.
It's because I think ESO is in a unique spot because it does play so well on console, like control-wise. Yeah. You don't have a bunch of hotbars. You've only got a few abilities at any given time. So
as an expert, Dan Tack,
yes,
just sexpert himself, would you recommend this game to Morrowind fans?
I mean, absolutely.
It's to that point where it's like, hey, if you're skeptical about ESO, but if you're nostalgic about Morrowind, quit beating around the bush, go play this.
Absolutely. Wow. From what I got to see the entire island. I got the grand tour. It is Morrowind, right? Like they've taken one-to-one scaling almost, like every attention to detail on these locations. And lots of like really cool, like since they're in the past, they can do all those kinds of like cool foreshadowing that leads up to what happens in The Elder Scrolls 3.
Are there scamps in it?
I think so, yeah.
Okay, cool. Right on. You guys want to move on to some great community emails?
Let's do it.
Great. And welcome back to the Game Informer Show. We got some great emails that people sent in to podcast@gameinformer.com. So many wonderful emails. I tried reading them off to Kyle, and he was overwhelmed and said, I got to get out of here. So now we have Ben Reeves joining us again.
Hello.
He ran out crying.
Yeah, what was the Netherrealm like, by the way, after you clapped? I was going to ask you.
It was total darkness and coldness. My grandmother was there, though.
Is that right? How's she doing?
Oh, she's great.
Cool.
She offered me tea.
Well, you guys should remember every email that's read off here, and then we're going to choose our favorite and ship them out something real nice. I hope it's Dan Tech's head, like the spirit of the forest at the end of Princess Mononoke.
Dude.
But like in a loving way, we're reconnected at the
end.
This
is brutal,
wonderful.
Man.
Dan, you look different.
I don't know what he's talking about.
You're a beautiful human being, Dan Tech.
I look the same. I know. That's what they tell me.
First email comes from a guy with a wonderful name named Howard Butterchurn. And the subject was Lorne Interview No-No. So I'm riveted out of the gate. He says, Ben Hansen, I wanted to punch you in the face during your Lorne Lanning of Oddworld Inhabitants interview from a while back. When Lorne asked if he could cuss in your interview with him, you said he could, but in post-production you bleeped him, which was a Weasley move, by the way.
A Weasley move?
You're not on the radio. You don't have to deal with the FCC's BS. YouTube would allow Lorne to cuss. Jesus, Ben, hoo-hoo. That always happens. We like having a clean podcast. I think it makes us different. I like that we stand out a little bit in the podcast field as far as games coverage goes by making it family friendly in theory, although some of the things Tack was saying, my lord. But as
also
far as guests,
looks.
I don't tell them ahead of time not to swear because I want them to be open and honest, and then I just bleep it afterwards. No big deal. I don't want to be like, hey, no, come on, great developer, shut up. It's just not going
to
care.
He wanted to punch you in the face.
Wow. Yeah. Sorry, Howard. It's the way it's
got to
be.
Good question. I got an answer to that. It's not really a big deal.
Great. So here's a fun one. Also, a lot of people going back to our older content, apparently, because this says, hey, guys, John Storm here, Game Informer editor from 1996 to 1998.
Wow.
Isn't
that wild?
That is
so he
wild.
Writes in, he says, first, watched and loved all 4 hours of the Final Fantasy VII Game Club you guys did last year. Secondly, I was on staff for the release of Final Fantasy VII. What I remember so vividly is Andy McNamara at his desk about 28 inches away from mine, whining a nasally F. That's the full curse word. 40 times in a row until he called the localization team at Squaresoft and told him that the Ruby weapon, and they told him that the Ruby weapon was for the end game. Not everyone remembers that Ruby wasn't in the Japanese original. It was added for the U.S.
That's right.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
It says the Japanese gamers were so mad at Square that they released Final Fantasy VII U.S. at full price in Japan, so everyone would have to buy it again to face Ruby. Then he says he laughed really hard when we were talking about how the Ultima spell potency varies across every Final Fantasy game, and apparently either you or I, Ben Reeves, said, Ultima is either unapproachably difficult or something I'd use on a frog on the world map. So thanks.
I don't remember who said that.
John Storm, former Game Informer editor. Thanks for writing
in. Hi, John.
Amazing. I love the idea of Andy playing in the U.S. version and just trying to take down Ruby the second he saw him for the first time.
Ruby is
pretty tough. So he thought he was required to beat at that point, like to move on?
I mean, maybe not that, but probably just assumed I should be able to beat this guy by now. But no, he's a threat. Let's see. William Hiddle from Layton, Utah says, make sure to let Dan Tack know that I always appreciate when he's on the podcast. He has a lot of experience with PC games and numerous other titles I've never played, which makes his insight particularly helpful. I tried Dark Souls after he wouldn't stop praising it, and I realized I hated it. I tried Final Fantasy IV, which he claims is his favorite, and I can't get to the end because it's too boring to play. I prefer 3D Zeldas to the top-down classics, and I'm avidly awaiting the Final Fantasy XII re-release this July because I really love that game. I won't give Darkest Dungeon the time of day. What I'm saying is Tack's opinion is just wrong. So wrongity, wrong, wrong, wrong. It's very kind of you all to tolerate his wrongness in the office. From William Hiddle.
Oh, well, that email took a real big turn. Yeah.
That twist. I love a good twist. Ooh. To be fair, there were several emails saying you're dead on about Final Fantasy XII. Also several saying you could not be more wrong. So
I knew you weren't going to be reading an email that just said I was great.
They're less fun. Yeah, they're less fun, Dan.
These are great questions too, by the way.
There's a lot of feedback that I love getting to, right? So, a guy named Ryan Davis wrote in, a guy named Zane Palmore, and also Reverend...
All these names sound fake. Zane Palmore?
Butterchurn.
Yeah, it's not real names like JV.
Exactly.
Also, Reverend John Michael Schweigert wrote in, the Reverend himself, all suggesting RTS adventure games. But they all kind of recommended games like Chaos Legions or this Hex Heroes... Baldur's Gate.
Are these PR people for these products?
Well, it's interesting because they all recommended stuff in the Brutal Legend vein, which isn't what I'm talking about. Okay. I'm talking about overhead camera. Mm-hmm. Anyways, thank you for that feedback. John Alden writes in and says, "Hey, GI crew, I'm a Minneapolis-based small business owner that decided to embrace Minnesota's unpopular Duck Duck Gray Duck version of the game and name my business after it. It's called Gray Duck Chai. It's down there by the Twin Cities Airport." He says, "Since then, we've discovered some of the origins of the game and why Minnesota isn't aligned with the rest of the country. The game itself has lots of different variations from different countries across the world. It's called the Postman, the Plump Sack, Towel Swirl."
No, I don't think it's called the Plump Sack. These are made-up names, Hanson.
But here's the crucial part that this John Alden writes in and says, "In Sweden, it is called Anka Anka Gra Anka. Translated to Duck Duck Gray Duck. Minnesota has the largest population of Scandinavian immigrants, so it makes sense that this version of the game landed here."
That is actually pretty fascinating.
Interesting.
That makes sense, too.
That's my Swedish roots coming through. So John also asks, "With the launch of the Nintendo Switch just around the corner," he's getting more and more excited, "what console launch throughout your lives was the most anticipated and exciting?"
Oh, PS2, without a doubt.
I'm totally with you, JB.
Really?
Super Nintendo Entertainment System.
So you're a huge NES fan, and the idea of a super version of that blew your mind? Yeah. And also, there's
16-bit graphics.
Dan, are you 57 years old?
Pretty close.
How could you be anticipating that game? I was barely aware that game was coming out, or that system was out.
Yeah. I was there. I was there for release.
And that's why you love Mario World so much? Because that was launch, right?
Yes, it was.
And
it was
that
launch.
Just blew your mind?
Amazing game.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like this is an oddball choice, but the GameCube. I was really excited about the GameCube, and I think it had to do with that lineup. I was really excited for Luigi's Mansion.
Yep.
And it wasn't day one, but like... Super Smash Brothers was an amazing game, and it came out really early. And I remember just staying up all night playing that and Luigi's Mansion with friends.
You weren't bummed out by Luigi's Mansion? Because I think there were those wave of people that were expecting, like, this is our Super Mario 64 for the system. Then they played it, and it's like, this is nothing like a platformer.
No, because, it was starring Luigi, so it wasn't... I didn't think of it as a Mario game, straight up Mario game, and I liked that it was different. I liked that it was a different kind of game.
PS2, I'm totally with you. I was so excited, JV. Came out... Tekken Tag SSX right out of the gate for me, and I didn't have a memory card, so I was just playing those games over and over again. But what were you excited for?
Oh, well, I got it, and I was really into Jak and Daxter. And it's weird because I ended up not liking it that much. Like, that was just what I was excited for because I love Crash Bandicoot.
Okay.
And then, it was a bunch of other, I don't even remember. I remember, basically that system being covered in dust until Metal Gear Solid 2 came out. And then I was super on board and like
that's
just
2001 wasn't too far.
Yeah, so I just kept buying games after that, really got back into gaming with my PS2.
Yeah. Right on.
But that's the one I remember okay, this is going to change everything. The graphics look so much better.
I remember ever being excited for that because of the Blu-ray. Not Blu-ray, sorry.
DVD.
DVD. Yeah, that was a big thing.
Got to convince my parents to get Gladiator on DVD. Let's find these Easter eggs in the menus. Yeah, it was a fun time. Sean writes in and says, "Hey, Game Informer crew, as members of the video game press, what are your views now on E3 selling 15,000 tickets per year to the general public? Do you welcome the addition of the public, or do you have concerns as to how it'll affect your E3 experience in regards to being able to perform your job?"
All right. First off, it's the only way the show is going to survive, right? People are pulling out in droves.
Yeah.
Got to get that. Got to get some attention going back at the developers back in there, and bringing the consumers in is great for that, I think. I do a lot of consumer-focused shows, and I always have a lot of fun at those. I don't think it's a big problem. I think it's cool that they're going to get in there, except the problem is now, you know, you have to make stuff. You have to make experiences for those consumers now, so it's different.
Do you think it's enough to lure in the big names back?
Yeah, that's a great question, right? I think EA is probably going to stay outside and do the thing that they did last year.
Whatever the hell that was, yeah.
Right, which apparently was really cool for the people that went. I don't know. I didn't get to go.
I wandered around a lot. I was just kind of confused overall, but maybe the public had a great time.
Right.
Yeah,
is it going to woo back in those booths? I don't know. Let's find out, huh?
But as far as the consumer, it's exciting just because, I mean...
It's great.
Following this industry for so long, it was just this legendary place where everything happened. Like, my God, someday I'd love to go to E3.
Right.
And it's like the Super Bowl.
Yeah, 15,000 tickets isn't much, but I think that's going to be really great if you can get a ticket and you are a fan just to finally experience what that's like.
Yeah. I remember one of the most exciting things my first year here was going to E3 with you guys. And
yeah.
Because, like, I'd always wanted to go. And actually... Going to E3 is different than, you know, what you expect it to be. It's
really? How so?
I would say working E3 is different than
working
E3. If you could just go and just,
you could
have
just go, that would be amazing.
Like yeah. It's, I don't know, like, I don't really feel like the public there, having the public there will necessarily get in the way of our jobs too much.
Everyone's whining about it.
It will be more packed.
It will be more packed, but at that point, like, when we're working, it's just going to be like, the seventh level of hell instead of the sixth level. You know, it's going to be a matter of degrees.
Yeah.
There are other factors to consider here as well. You know, you could technically, as a member of the public, do E3. It was a little bit dicier to do it, but you could definitely go whenever you wanted. This isn't like a new thing. I mean, it wasn't being promoted.
Even though we don't know what E3 will look like this year, do you guys have pro tips for a public going to?
Wear comfortable shoes that are broken in.
Okay.
You're probably going to walk around a lot, or at least you want to. Be prepared to stand in line. So probably bring your 3DS or something.
Yeah, for sure.
Have a water bottle.
Dan
on
apparently
you.
Doesn't have to stand in line.
No, don't stand in lines. If you're going there just to stand in line, just don't do it.
What would we recommend doing?
I don't know. Just get in there.
Not going, apparently, because you're going to have to stand in line.
Experience
Dan.
The industry. Everyone in the industry is there. So annoy them, right? Like, that's.
Talk to people.
Yeah,
this is
people.
Terrible advice, but okay.
I mean, don't annoy them. You get my point. Like, you're there. You can see all the gaming legends. They'll all be there.
Yeah.
So, like.
Don't stand in the corner for the whole show.
Exactly.
Go check out some indie games. Talk to an indie developer.
Yeah. And indie games are great.
Definitely.
Fewer lines.
Yeah.
And they're always willing to talk, like the indie developers, to anyone, pretty much. Yeah.
For sure. Joel from Westford, Massachusetts says, hello, Game Informer Show. Hello. I had a hunch that this month's cover story would be Breath of the Wild. How shrewd, Joel. But the cover story is so... I hope it's not because I kind of didn't exactly spoil it, but on a podcast a couple months ago, I said, like, oh, I'd love to talk about more about Breath of the Wild, but... I was like, I wonder if people would ever read into that, but I don't think anybody picked
up on
it.
Handsome.
Anyway, so Joel says he had a hunch, but the cover story is so close to the game's actual release date. Have there ever been other instances like this in the magazine's past? If so, was it due to last-minute meetings or other such complications, or was Nintendo just now starting to accept in-depth coverage like this? This is a rare case. I think it just lined up really well.
Right? It's happened before.
With this case, it just lined up really well with the Switch event and whatnot, so it all worked out. But, I mean, Destiny Rise of Iron was really
Destiny
close
to
release.
It was like 2 months, right? Like not
that
two.
Was maybe the closest, at least
we
in the recent past.
Did a Bully one way back in the day that was like a month before the game released. And we did a Blue Dragon one, I think, was early on in my tenure, which the game, I think, was like out in Japan. It just hadn't come to the U.S. yet.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, I kind of like it when it varies up. There's nothing set in stone. And so I kind of, it's fun to have a first look at a game, even if it's in really rough shape and kind of reveal new details. But it's also really nice to do a... one that's later in the cycle and close to release because you have so much more gameplay footage to work with.
These are big hands on time. They're willing to talk about a lot.
Yeah. Instead of just like, we can't talk about the story right now because this is the first beat. No real reason behind it, Joel. Just the way chips fell. Andrew writes in and says, hello, Ben and the rest of GI Crew. The Curse of Monkey Island is one of the first games my brother and I played, and they really loved it. Curse of Monkey Island, the third one. Interesting.
No good.
Hey, come on. Perhaps our favorite quote of all time takes place when Guybrush Threepwood has to make a volcano erupt so he can get hand lotion. Don't ask. But it's blocked by a village of vegan savages wearing tribal masks made out of giant fruit. Huh. After listening to their leader give a long pre-sacrificial invocation, complete with nutritional information for the sacrifice, Guybrush tosses a wheel of cheese into the lava, at which point their leader says, in the most condescending SoCal accent ever, you fool, you've given cheese to a lactose-intolerant volcano god. You've brought about the coming of the divine dysentery. Which is, so he says, my question is, what are some of your favorite obscure quotes from games? So the idea is that Andrew and his brother will constantly quote that entire line, which is probably just a thrill for those LucasArts employees who are probably worried about the script of the third Monkey Island. But that had an impact, man.
That's a weird quote, too, because like vegan back then would have been, nobody would have heard of what a vegan was, I think.
There was a big Guybrush conversation where they explained the merits of what vegans were.
I always liked Metal Gear Solid's lines. I always remember the one about like, behind D. Like, what's behind D doing here? Like,
just,
nonstop. It's a great line.
I can't see the word liquid either without just laughing.
Well, I got all the recessive genes.
It's so good. It's liquid. I have a dumb one that I think about way too much, but
no way.
In the you'll never buy it. In Dragon Ball Z Budokai, the fighting series on PS2, every time Krillin shoots an energy blast, he goes, "Can you feel it? Can you feel it? Can you feel it?" And he just says that so many times. So when I have that in my head more than you could possibly imagine, is "Can you feel it" from Krillin?
For me, it's the original Half-Life, just because. Like all the guard, because of the models, like all the security guards, all the Barneys look the same, the exact same. And they all say, catch me later, I'll buy you a beer. And like, that's just one of their prompts. And you hear it so much across it. And like, when I was playing that game and I was 9 years old, for some reason, I just thought it was the same guy over and over again and not just a different security guard. So it's just like, he's immortal. I saw him get squished.
It's a science lab. Anything can happen, man.
Does it count as a line if it's just like you quoting Mario? Like, waha!
Yeah, that's a thorough classic video game line. Is Mario touching lava?
I mean, I'm sure
that all the time.
I'm sure if Kyle was here answering this question, he'd just go, "Hiya!"
That's classic Kyle. Alex from Georgia says, "What is the achievement or trophy you are most proud of for obtaining? Mine would be the invincible achievement in Mega Man 10. You have to complete the game without dying. What stands out to you
guys?
That's
pretty impressive.
Are you guys big achievement people?
Dan, are you an achievement guy?
No, I'm not. I think they're ridiculous. Like,
really? I wouldn't have expected that from you.
It's just like a little breadcrumb trail. I mean, they're cool if you like them, whatever, but like...
Yeah,
I never
indeed they are. A lot of people really like them.
I never pay attention to them at all.
Yeah, my issue is when I first heard about like gamer score and trophies and whatnot, I was like, oh, cool, maybe they'll tie this into something like Nintendo does, where, you know, you can get points and then use them to like buy merchandise or something.
Sure.
And that they've never done that has always bummed me out, because that's the one thing... You know, trophies, I guess it's cool to see that little icon pop up on my screen. Be like, all right, that's cool. I beat a boss. I was going to get this eventually.
Yeah.
I guess, you know, clean hands in Dishonored. That was the first time, like, you know, went through the game, didn't get seen, didn't kill anyone.
Yeah.
That's the first time I saw it and was like, I'm a little proud of this.
Nice.
Yeah.
I don't think I've never looked at an achievement and then tried to achieve it. I don't think I've ever opened up my achievements on Xbox. Maybe once on PS4. Like, it's just not a part of my gaming life at all. I turned off as many notifications as I can. Reeves, are you into that?
Not really. I think we got the wrong crew for this question.
Yeah,
I do
we
remember,
need a writer in here, man.
Yeah. I did all the achievements for the first Mass Effect. And I think, because you have to play that game like 3 times or something to get them all. And
oh,
I think doing that early on, I was like, I don't know if I need to go for every achievement ever.
Yeah.
But I did that one time, and that was good.
Well, then you'll love Lucas's question from Canton, Texas, Reeves. He says, BioWare's recent announcement of a new IP coming next April has me excited. Did they announce a date? I don't think they did. Anyways, we are getting a whole new universe with heavily suggested online components from some of the best world builders.
Mm-hmm.
My question is, since they've already done sci-fi with Mass Effect, fantasy with Dragon Age, what type of universe would you like to see BioWare create for us next? Thanks, and keep up the good work on the podcast and the consistently hilarious Sonic the Hedgehog Super Replay. Good job, Reeves.
Yeah. Tune in.
Member
find out all about it. We're getting a lot of shout-outs.
Yeah.
What do you guys want from the new IP? What's that?
Member Shadow Realms? I mean, come on. You can't just, like, you know, that was a thing. That didn't happen.
So you're saying they're going to cancel the new
IP?
I'm
just saying.
You think they're just going to bring it back?
No, I mean.
What are you saying, Dingus?
What am I saying? I don't know.
What do you want, JV?
Well, I mean, if it's a new IP, it's not Jade Empire, which is what I want them to go back to.
More the new IP, you would.
Well,
want them...
I want Jade Empire to go on, because that's their weirdest game. Like, I went back and played it 2 years
ago.
I'd
argue the Sonic Dark Brotherhood's their
weirdest
game.
Well, that's their weirdest game that matters.
Okay.
Yeah, but I was just remembering, man, this is funky. Like, all the fighting styles and the characters. But if it's sci-fi, if we have to say some new genre, you know, maybe something steampunky, I guess.
Well, that's certainly, so they released concept art.
And it looks sci-fi.
It looks something. So I think it's from 2014, the E3, and who knows how much it changed. Could have been rebooted 6 ways to Sunday since then. But it looks, it could be sci-fi or it could be post-apocalyptic.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Cobbled together housing. I'm leaning towards post-apocalyptic. All they've said is, It'll have modern stories, dynamic worlds, and they want to bring people together.
Man, it would
I didn't know I didn't want post-apocalyptic until you said it.
Yeah, like, yeah, it's just such a bummer.
I am tired of post-apocalyptic.
Well, it can be done, okay, in the same way that Horizon Zero Dawn is post-apocalyptic. Like, there's plenty of variety within that banner.
And, like, you know, the original Mass Effect, I'm sure when that was coming up, you were like, oh, well, cool, another Star Wars-esque game. And then they did.
I guess. But generic
cool things about that.
Sci-fi sounds cooler to me than post-apocalyptic. We'll see. I mean, they have the fantasy, they have sci-fi, so post-apocalyptic makes sense. But I really prefer something different, like the like you said, Jade Empire or steampunk or something cool like
that. I want something like Earthbound.
Yeah, that would modern be nice. Day, like Harry Potter-style magic.
I mean, they already had that with Shadow Realms, though, so I doubt they're doing that again.
Although, with Aaron Flynn in the interview that we did during our Mass Effect coverage, which you can go back and watch, we talked about the new IP a little bit. I joked with him because he's an Undertale fan. He confirmed that the new IP is not a licensed Undertale game, so there's a hot scoop.
Ooh.
Also, he said that it was more finished than you'd think. They've been quiet for a long time up there in Edmonton. It is, in theory, a lot of the leads from the Mass Effect 3 team and that bulk of development team that have been working on this thing, so... And also, they in that interview, Aaron Flynn talked a lot about how they're thinking a lot about co-op stories within BioWare, outside of Old Republic even. Mm-hmm. So that could be where they're going with this.
How much do you think they'll kind of like follow what Bungie did with Destiny? Kind of follow that formula?
That seems
like
to be the rumor.
Co-op, some kind of something light like RPG action, maybe shooter.
The question is what modern stories means. When they say modern stories, is that just adult, sophisticated, complicated? What are they trying to convey with
it's
that?
It's actually about the Trump presidency.
Oh, please.
Probably be like a girl on the train. Kind of. Let's move on.
Anyways, Anthony from Malvern, Pennsylvania writes in and says, hey, Ben and company, my wife is obsessed with the Sims games. My question is, why are there not more games like it? I watch her play Sims 3, and it's so rudimentary and simple, it seems as if a developer were to make one for this generation, it could be extremely detailed and complex. Yes, I feel like that formula is ripe for a City Skylines style reboot from another developer, but it's amazing. It hasn't happened yet. No one's going for that cash pile of cash, right?
Yeah, I guess.
Or is it all just mobile now and whatever?
Right. I think a lot of the simulation stuff has moved to mobile as part of...
We need more games like The Herbs.
Also, they ask genuinely, if you could create JV in a Sims game, how would you torture him in it?
No, really? That's Yeah. I don't believe you.
I make him roommates Hanson with Dan Tack.
I did not. That is actually from Anthony in Pennsylvania here. I would spam my keyboard looking for those nude codes. It would just be violent keyboard.
Man, I'd hope that they do the thing where they put me in the swimming pool and then take out the ladder. So I just swim until I'm exhausted.
That's always
drown.
A fun one. Yeah.
Moving the shower. You had to like put in a code that you can move objects while they're in use, and then you could like move the shower, and it's like this weird pixelated person like writhing. It's cool times.
I always like
Sims.
Putting the barbecue in a contained room where they couldn't.
Oh,
get
setting
out.
Them on fire.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Hello, GI Show crew. This is Nick from Atlanta, where all the fourth quarter plays are made up, and your 25-point leads don't matter.
That's right.
Heck
That's
yeah.
right, buddy.
So Nick from Atlanta says, "Hello, special hello to Wade."
Oh, Wade.
Because
Wade.
I have some questions for you and Ben. First, for Wade, this is Wade Wojcik, video editor, who quietly sits in the booth during every recording of the podcast. He's the one switching and running the wheels of steel back there. Wade, say hello.
Hello.
So he's here for every episode. So Nick has a question. What are you usually doing in the booth when the GI Show or other features are getting taped, Wade? I've noticed sometimes there will be different audio cues that I'd assume you initiate, but what else?
So it's a lot of... note-taking, random things I got to put in later. A lot of times Reiner will say, hey, we'll flash a picture right now, stuff like that. I do like, I have fun with piping in, you know, random audio things during like replay and, you know, preparing images for the show later on, just a lot of miscellaneous stuff. And then maybe, I don't know, game of Clash Royale.
He also glares at us whenever we talk about Halo out here. Like I can feel his eyes over there.
When do you?
Kyle did that earlier.
What?
No, that's very true. Also, taking notes for the podcast. So for the YouTube version of the show, we put gameplay in, stuff like that. And then just like quietly eating a giant burrito back there.
Wade eats lunch at 4 p.m. every day.
Yeah, he does.
That's
really
right.
Weird.
He's got the weirdest eating schedule.
Nick also asks how much the video version of the show is edited. A little trimming here and there, some technical thing happens, whatnot. He says they can't see the cuts. They should be pretty apparent. We have like flashes as a transition. But anyways, John from Chicago. Says, hey, Ben and crew, as the manager of a recently opened escape room in the Chicago suburbs, I've noticed a lot of overlap between our clientele and people who play video games. My question to you is whether any of you have any experience with escape rooms or other physical games like that. What do you think? Also, this person's been listening to every episode since the very first Helgeson podcast. which is amazing. Wow.
Thanks, dude.
Yeah, they're pretty fun.
I like escape rooms. I've only done one. I did one. It was kind of like James Bond themed. Yeah. But it was fun. Like, you're in an office, like, just finding all the puzzles, working together with, like, four other dudes to try to, like, disarm this bomb, basically.
It's a fun idea.
It's a really cool idea, yeah.
As long as the production values are up there. Yeah, I hope John's and Chicago's can nail it. But.
Yeah, there's an escape the room, actually, like, a couple of blocks from where I live.
Yeah.
And it just looks, every time I walk past it, it just looks really crummy. And I'm, like, kind of convinced it's actually a torture chamber where they just lead you down into the basement and lock you in there.
Wow, this is really getting deep.
I've certainly been to some that have been pretty cheap, where it's like, hey, it's sci-fi themed. And at the end, if you lose, a monster is going to come out and kill you. And then it's just like, nope, I guess time's up. It's too bad.
The monster guy.
I would want the guy in a Barney outfit to come in and at least, like, make it fun. But it's just like, nope, whatever. You lost. Get out. It's very disappointing. Anyways, Anthony Kane writes in from Pennsylvania and says, hello, GI Podcast crew. JB, do you have any liquid in that cup?
Yes.
Okay, can you read this email?
Sure. Which one? The one at the bottom?
Mm-hmm.
I am a funeral... Hello, GI Podcast crew. I'm a funeral director, and as such, I'm responsible for a great many things, meeting with families, procuring and filing important state and federal death records, and preparing recently deceased individuals for viewings and funeral services, to name a few. Sometimes when I am in the funeral home prep room where I complete an embalming when necessary, I listen to the GI show as I do my work. Have you ever imagined that your voices could ever wind up in such a strange place? Where are some of the strangest or wildest places you've ever imagined people listening to your podcast? I'm interested to see where your minds will take you. I enjoy your show immensely. Keep up the good work. Also, thank you for engaging all your fans on Twitter. It's fun to see those interactions. Be well, Anthony J. Kane from Philadelphia.
Thank you, Anthony. We have a blanket policy for the Game Informer show. If you're literally touching a corpse, don't listen to our podcast. We love you. We want as many listeners as possible. Tell your friends if you like the show. If you have your hand up some dead person, just turn the podcast off. For my sanity, it really weirds me out.
Well, okay. Do you think, let's take this in the opposite direction then.
Yeah. Oh, lovemaking?
Yeah, do you think people have listened to us, our 100%. Voices, while they have
I guarantee
sex?
That they do.
Or while I handling can guarantee babies? This. While handling a newborn?
Well, hell, no. Let's combine the two. Do we think Anthony... No, I'm just... it's a complicated thing. I think about it a lot, where, like, I'm listening to a podcast that I love when I'm in some other country, where it's like, oh, I bet this person never thought that I'd be walking the streets of Poland listening to their voice. You know, I love having the weird international angle of people all over the world listening to podcasts.
They totally listen to us while they poop.
Oh, all the time.
Realized it.
I mean,
right?
Sure.
The second you said the word poop, there was a splash in a toilet. I absolutely guarantee that's the case.
That one guy.
I'm getting out of here.
Oh my God. What a coincidence.
Yeah. Let's see. We have Bradley St. Clair writes in. Simple question. What multiplayer game are you best at? For me, it's Mario Kart on the Wii. Interesting.
Titanfall 2. I wreck everybody.
Really?
Like, I just destroy them.
Out of any game, you're the best. Oh, yeah. Player, multiplayer-wise, at that. Okay. Yeah. Dan Tack, what are you?
I don't know. Like, that I'm the best at? Like,
yeah. Is everything an option? I can't quite...
I can't pick them all, right?
Uh-huh. Humility.
I'm not so good at that game.
Yeah,
in fact,
no
I'm really bad at it.
No kidding.
I used to be really good at Pokemon Puzzle League. Back
you think? Oh, what an interesting choice. Yeah. I was also going 64. I was thinking Perfect Dark Multiplayer.
Oh, that's
I think
one.
It's the only thing where I felt like I can... reliably kick some butt with this. As
I can
long
reliably
Slayer and Ravine.
I think we should button, play man. Some.
Okay, let's do it. I know for Christ's sake that I'm better than Dan Tack at Age of Mythology.
You won one game.
Mopping of the floor. Dan was nearly in tears by the end of that
game. You won one game. Congratulations.
Adam Spiros from St. Louis, Missouri says, hello, GI crew. I think you guys got the whole, that's right, thing from David Putty on Seinfeld.
That's right.
That is right.
That is right. Yeah.
Some people wrote in and said, that's just Putty from Seinfeld. That's right. 100% that is Putty, and I completely forgot. Yeah, I love Seinfeld.
Well,
we all do.
You were telling me about your friend who, like, was not aware of this email in any way, but the day after that podcast said the same thing.
Yeah, hey, you idiot. You're just doing Putty. It's like, oh, yeah. Oh, duh. Of course. let's see.
Oh, that's rich.
Verped wrote in and says, you guys shouldn't tell people to like and subscribe to you. Besides being annoying, when YouTubers tell me to like and subscribe to them, I unsubscribe from them out of spite. I'm not a subscriber to anyone on YouTube. It's just my own little way of being a rebel. Sorry, but we want other people to hear the show.
Yeah,
so
I mean, that's an anomaly. Like, I mean, people wouldn't do it if it didn't actually, you know, motivate people to do that. So, like,
but you can do it too much. I understand it being the cliche, and Dan's trying to make it ironic, but it's still a cliche. But it's tough when you do a show that you're proud of and you want people to hear it.
Right.
When we do it ironically, it's okay.
Is that right?
Yeah, that way we get the benefits and none of the, you know, bad taste. It's great.
So like and subscribe to our show.
No, but I would not say the cliche, but I do, from the bottom of my heart, wish that if people do like the show, tell some other gamer friends or non-gamer friends about it. Like, right. we care about that kind of thing. Subscribe to the audio version if you're just watching the video. Seth from Portland says, hey, GI crew, question. When you get a nice big old plate of fresh French fries and you gonna get some ketchup on those bad boys,
I know where this is going.
Do you prefer to squirt ketchup over the entire fry collection or just have a puddle on the side that you dip the fries into?
Oh, you gotta have a puddle.
I'm incredibly interested in your answers and I desperately hope you agree with my preferred style because my pals think I'm a big weirdo for doing it my way. Which he doesn't say what it is.
Oh, it's clearly that he drizzles the fries.
He's a drizzler. Yeah. We got a drizzler here.
All right. So first off, it's insane. You shouldn't put ketchup on fries, ever.
What are you talking about?
Ketchup is just gross, and it shouldn't be on any food. It destroys
any
it.
Food.
Shut up.
There's
any
a reason food. It's popular. You
it's the
buffalo.
Like most favorite condiment in the
yeah,
world.
Yeah, because it's so generic.
Because people like
crappy.
To say ketchup.
Use something else. Get That's yourself why. A nice like aioli or something. You know?
This is worse than your lobster bisque stuff.
Tough.
Really? So. Curly fries, any sort of fry, tater tot.
There are all kinds of great stuff you can put on fries and tots. Mm. Ketchup should not be one of them.
Gotta have
what
tots.
Number?
If you gotta use ketchup, maybe like some spicy sriracha ketchup, maybe.
All right.
That's acceptable.
Okay. Yeah, that's
ketchup.
Probably better.
Okay.
Sriracha ketchup.
That's
ketchup.
You can't just take it some Heinz 50, you know, and just...
Yeah. Yes, you
that's
can.
Gross. You can. You shouldn't, is the difference.
Here's the thing. With the drizzle strategy, don't care for it. Everyone's gonna dip. All right, yeah. They'll like dipping.
You ever have that at a restaurant where they deliver it and it's already drizzled on your ketchup and you're like, oh.
I would.
You throw it back at them.
Absolutely. Spit it out of my mouth.
Like Dan Tack.
Yeah. I feel like the only way the drizzle is acceptable is if you're eating it with a fork, right? And so like poutine, this is an exception. Yeah. I will drizzle some ketchup on poutine, which I understand is sacrilege to poutine connoisseurs like JV over here. But then eating it with a fork, understand. But if it's with hands, tater tots, french fries, anything, you got to dip.
Yeah, right, because then your hands are messy and it's just gross.
Just get
it's
yourself
just
some,
gross.
Some tachos, man. Let's do
tachos
this right.
Is the way to go?
Sure. Yeah.
All right, you guys. Favorite email of the week. What do you like?
That's it. Well, let's do the funeral guy, man. He needs
the
some
funeral
help.
Guy, yeah.
Funeral let's, man.
I think let's, he needs a gift.
Look, we need our magazines or, you know, whatever we're sending out hanging up over the casket.
Yeah.
I
oh god, it scares me.
He's embalming people while listening to us. It's
god, that's I, commitment.
If he doesn't win, I don't know who does. That's
I like favorite console point. Release.
I no embalming there. Man.
Yeah,
embalming.
Come
you know
on. What?
That's like the most unique.
Sure, favorite that, console right. release was coupled with the Grey Duck feedback, which it I really appreciate. Not. It was insightful. There's a lot of great feedback. Feedback,
embalming
but
feedback. And.
Anthony Kane.
Yes.
The old crypt maker himself.
Weirdo.
Hey, all right, Anthony.
Anthony, to make up for you, you need to listen to our podcast while making love to counteract.
1-to-1. It needs to be that
really
ratio.
Gotta,
I'm telling you, it works.
Is but
it
not in a funeral home.
Come on. All right, Anthony, congratulations. We're going to ship you something else. We're going to ship you out something real nice. The nicest thing you've ever seen in your life. All right, and now stay tuned for an interview all about For Honor. It's a good chat with a very passionate creative director named Jason, so stay tuned for that. Jason, welcome to the Game Informer Show, sir.
That's great to be here.
Yeah, thanks for joining us, man. It's an exciting time for Honor. You guys are ramping up to some betas, to the release. People are finally getting to play it. I see commercials on TV where it's like, hey, play for free. It's open beta right now. Go for it. So it's going to be exciting on your end, right?
Oh, it's amazing. This is what it's all been about, right? Is getting to the point where we can switch on the servers and unleash the hordes, right? So it's epic. It's truly epic. And we're playing with we're making millions of new friends. It's fantastic.
Is that right? So I played a bit of the closed beta, and the biggest takeaway is like you've made a really interesting, bizarre game. From what I can tell. So how are you feeling about it at this point? You're basically wrapping things up, right?
Well, yeah. So, I mean, for me, of course, my part's been over for a while, right? Like I've been, we're in that closing period, the creative director is the last person they want to hear from, right? They're like, we know you have new ideas. That's great and everything. Can you talk about them to someone else? but for me, it's this game has always been sitting inside of me for like 15 years now. This system that you're talking about, that fighting system, the Art of Battle fighting system, it's something that I thought would work, right? And I tried to convince people for 10 years that it would work. And then finally I got this yes and built the team and built the game. And what's incredible about it is that people hit it and you have that experience like, wow, this is new. What is this? But then within about, 30 seconds, you know, maybe a couple minutes, people have forgotten how weird it was and are just beating each other with swords and making it work, right? It's fantastic. I love to watch the love of melee combat kind of spread.
Where did it come from with you? Because you also worked on Red Steel 2. Was that kind of some of the ideas you were experimenting with back then?
No, that was this. It started way before then.
Okay.
This is my topic, man. This is the thing. I took a course in German longsword. Was what happened. Which is an actual thing. It's Western martial arts. And I was living in San Francisco at the time, and you know, learning these forms. Which, if you've played The Warden, you're seeing a lot of those forms. And I thought that I was so impressed by the system, how simple and clear it was. I thought, what would happen if we took these stances and we put them on the right stick? What if, you know, we did this, what would happen? And I walking down the, you know, walking home from the dojo, and I'm suddenly pantomiming like, oh, and then it would be this, and then, oh, and then we could do, and then it would be the attacks and the, ooh, and I got all excited, right? Carrying my wooden sword home, pantomiming like a madman. It was, must've been quite a thing. So then I started pitching to people. I was like, hey, I think that this would, if we did this control layout, if we did this kind of control scheme, that it would make you feel the way I feel when I pick up a weapon and I do it for real. Like I go out on the field and, you know, there's this weird tension about you're looking at your enemy and you're observing their defense and trying to guess what they're going to do, but also trying to get your weapon in there, but also preserve your own safety at the same time, that weird mix. That's really what was the goal. So I pitched that for like 10 years. And it was no. 10 years, man, long time. And then I pitched it at Ubisoft Montreal here, and I got a no but.
Hey, there we go. That's good enough,
I got
man.
No but. I have somebody I want you to meet, and I pitched it to the team here, Stefan Cardin, and the producers. Was a producer here, and this team that had worked on Naruto and Prince of Persia and a bunch of combat stuff, and they were like, "Yeah, let's give it a try."
That's awesome.
And that was 5 years ago, so now we're shipping this monster.
Why do you think it's relatively untapped in the game industry? I'm sure like high-level fighting games has this to some extent. I know a lot of people are comparing this to Bushido Blade, but why is it not... Oh, you're a huge Bushido Blade fan?
Well, I have the disc on my mantle at home, no big deal.
Really?
Yeah.
What a pull!
But that game was the first time I picked up a controller. I tried it. It was the first time that I was like, oh, this is how it feels. This is how it feels. You have that terror of their weapon and this, like, you're going to fuck it up. And I would always miss, like, oh no. Right. Like that was Bushido Blade was, oh dear God.
Yeah.
Right. Like that was the experience. But it felt, it had true emotions of combat. And, but then we went a different direction, right? We went away from that with game design. We went to where fighting games have gone. And yeah, I'm delighted to be coming back to the kind of the, what I think of as the emotional center of fighting, which is the, observing your opponent's stance and this queer, you know, this simple, you know, being in control of your own defense system. And
right, right. Just a little more deliberate, a little more intimate. It is bizarre.
But simple. Yeah. Simple enough that it activates your lizard brain, right? Simple enough that you're not thinking about the combos. You're like, he's going to hit me in the thing, right? Like, like it's really, it's visceral. It's in your body. When you learn it, it's quick now when you learn it, right? I think I love to see people like, right, like that's the goal.
So do you consider it a simple game? I've heard a lot of people with the beta be like, I don't really understand some of the game modes going on in here. Even if you understand like the basics and you can handle a 1v1 or a 2v2, do you still argue that it is a simple game to grasp?
I think it's a simple game to learn.
Okay.
It is absolutely a difficult game to master, but that's what we want, right? We want a game that has rules that are and systems that are deep enough that there's kind of an endless opportunity for mastery, but that you can get into it, like you say, like you can get in and you can start being effective and getting into that fantasy almost immediately, right? That was the goal. That's what we love with video games. I wanted to make this game for, you know, anyone with a sword fighting fantasy like that. You know, if you've ever opened that the catalog and browsed through, you know, when you were 14 and you get that catalog in the mail that has all the weapons, the medieval weapons in it, and you're like, I want that one, right? That's me, right? Like I'm making games for that, you know, for anyone who was into that, right? Who was just, whoever thought I might be a warrior, right? And that meant making it as accessible, as simple as we could make it, right?
Yeah, for sure. So it's a hell of a shot to have this idea for so long, finally get the green light within Ubisoft Montreal, like, let's ramp up, AAA, let's give it its all. What is that process like? Like, what opened that door a crack finally along the way?
You know, I've had some time to reflect on it. I think I got better at pitching, honestly. I think I kind of sucked at it in the beginning. I was like, you know, I have this interesting mechanical idea, right? And by the end, when I finally pitched, it was to Yanis Malat, he's the managing director here, the general manager at Ubisoft Montreal. He was like, he took me to lunch. He says, what do you really want to do, Jason? Like, you know, just, you know, anything. What do you want to do? I'm like, what do I want to do? I'm all pissed. I'll tell you what I want to do.
You grab the knife off the table.
Yeah, like, because you know, was it 10 years of saying no, right? 10 years of people saying no. I'm like, I told him, I'll tell you what I want to do, and you're going to tell me no, because we don't make games like this. But what I want to do is I want to change the way that we think about fighting, and I want to put the emotions of the battlefield onto the controller and really just, like, you know, create that martial warrior experience, but for everybody. That's what I want to do.
I'd imagine it must be tough too, because there's so much IP at Ubisoft. It seems like an idea where it's like, you know, maybe down the road with Assassin's Creed we could rework the combat system to incorporate some of those ideas, Jason.
Right. When you approach it rationally, I think that was the difference, is that when you approach it rationally like that, when you're like, well, this is interesting as a concept, right? Then then you kind of get stuck over there. But I think the reason that the pitch kind of took was that I wasn't approaching it from that standpoint anymore. I was like, yeah, technical, schmechnical. What I want to do is I want to put a freaking sword in your hand, you know, and, you know, give you that weird sense, that mix of like adrenaline and danger and terror and bravery that real combat gives you. This feeling of like, I need to pay complete attention that's locked in on my enemy and what they're doing, but I also need to not forget that they have friends, because, you know, they can, right, like that, and that weird feeling of like, okay, we're gonna fight and only one of us is gonna walk away from this. And then that happens again and again and again. Those emotions are so intense, but they're so human. We've been doing that to each other longer than we've had language. You know, like, it's a very, very old experience, this one, right, that we sort of brought to life. And yet there wasn't a video game that felt that way. I didn't think I don't know of another video game that captures that sort of battlefield, you know, sort of elite warrior fantasy in the way that For Honor does.
Yeah.
I'm really proud of that.
Yeah, for sure. So such a solid core idea. Was there ever any discussion of making it like a you know, grow home scale project, or why keep packing more and more on top of it? Because it seems like it could just be like a cool little duel, right?
Yeah, I guess so. We have the duel in there, right? Like, you know. But actually, when we started the game, when we started from the very beginning, we had some initial prototypes. We had like 400 prototypes. We made a bunch of prototypes. We had some that were initially that were just doing the duel, so we were working out the combat. But as soon as we could, we were like, 4v4, let's get on a battlefield, let's do multiple things. Because it was clear to us that the magic of this combat happens when you're dealing with the unpredictable nature of a battle, right? Where it's not a tournament with people applauding, right? This is a field where everyone's kind of committed, and this matters to somebody, you know, like it's important in some way. And that the complexity and the interest that comes from having people who you're fighting with and alongside and against, right, was always kind of core to the experience. I don't know. We started small, like we started with a small team of, you know, like 20 people, and kind of slowly grew over time. But like a lot of projects at Ubisoft, it grew as it sort of proved itself, right? As it we would pass through these gates and people would go, they would get excited about it because we would do these tournaments and try out the game. Even when it was just stick figures, people got really excited about it. And so I think that's, you know, why did it get bigger and stuff, is because we could, right? We kept saying, yeah, let's go, let's do it. Like, let's, you know, we as a team, we kept saying, yes, there's more we could do here. It's amazing that we made it, you know, that we made it this far.
Is it tough to keep like core concept as like your guiding star along the way? Do you worry about things getting watered down? Do you have to have like a sticky note on your monitor being like, hey, don't ever deviate from this core concept as we put more and more systems in this thing?
Yeah, well, it's my job.
Yeah.
That's my job. So if we deviate from the core concept, then I've failed, basically. That's the concept. And we do that. Like, I had, for me, the core, like I have at the very big, sort of the core of this game, I have this belief, I believe that very deeply, that combat is an art form. like capital A art form. And I discovered that I'm not alone in that belief. And I think also that like warriors are artists who sometimes give their life in the defense of what they believe in. Right. Which is intense, but that's how I believe that. Right. I think that that's really true. And I just happen to believe that combat with weapons, this martial style of combat, is the most beautiful sort of, you know, compelling, dangerous, tense. It's the one that I like the most. It's my favorite version of that, even though that concept applies to all kinds of combat, right? Even if it's just social sparring or whatever, right? So what I wanted to do was I wanted to create a game that captured that love of the art of combat. And not necessarily as a specific, like this person or this specific faction, but as the whole thing, like give you enough of a selection of types of warriors and types of fighting that you could find your warrior, your sort of inner, fight artist, right? Battle artist, and you can get out on that field and let your inner warrior play, right? That was always the goal. So we have those things. I mean, I had a bunch of other ones, like it's, you have those. You know, you make those sticky notes and you share them with the team. That's how you keep people on track.
Yeah. So when this game was announced, you're out at E3. I think it was the announcement. And you really gave it your all on that stage. It could not have shown more enthusiasm unless you're like bleeding from the eyes. I don't know what else you'd do. How important is it for the team just to have that huge enthusiasm and that huge rallying moment like that?
Well, it was, I mean, that moment was incredible for us, but it's funny because people always are like, oh man, you were so amped up there. I'm like, it's just how I am. I'm not just like, I only have one speed. Like it just works really well in that moment. Right. Like, but it, cause I'm always like, that's how I feel about this topic. Right. It's just, it was amazing. It was an amazing moment. Cause first we made it all the way to that moment when the trailer started and nobody knew.
Yeah.
Right. It was a total surprise. Right. That's hard to do.
It wasn't even in Watch Dogs 1, which is a miracle for you guys. I don't know how you pulled that off. Yeah,
exactly. So it was a huge moment for us because we knew with this game, with this concept, it's so new as a way to play. It's a reinterpretation, a whole new way to do something that people already know how to do, which
it's
is fight, right?
Primal but new. Yeah, it's a weird mix.
Yeah, exactly. So it's this weird moment, right? We knew that we were going to have to go out live, and we were going to have to say, not just say, oh yeah, it's going to make you feel this way, but go like this, like, and here's how, right?
Yeah.
And so we did it. We got, you know, we had the team and those 8 dev team members who got up there and they just played the game live on stage. It all worked. It was amazing. It was an unbelievable moment.
Yeah. So with what I'd imagine is, as you mentioned, a growing, ballooning team, and it's gigantic now. What have you learned about being a team leader from this experience? Because you've led projects before, right? But this must be night and day.
Yeah. Oh, this is totally different. I've gone through like 3 complete new theories of leadership.
Oh, please walk through all of them. I would love it.
Well, I mean, you know, when I started here, I had these core concepts about this is the kind of game I wanted to make, but I was really focused on design, right? I was really focused on like, it would be, here's how it would work, right? That was really how I started. And a lot of my early pitches and my early conversations were like, I think the mechanics would be like this. And it turns out that that's interesting. It's okay. It doesn't, the problem with that approach is that if you're not in the room, then the team is like, well, where's the guy to tell us how it's going to work, right? And so what I learned was that I learned to communicate in terms of the principles that the target, like what are we shooting for? How do we want this mechanic to feel? What's the player's goal here? How do we want the player to experience this mechanic, this moment? What are we going for in terms of the goal to kind of hand it off? Because we hire these incredibly talented people, right? These amazing, experienced, passionate game developers, right? What they want is they want a problem to solve, not a solution to execute, right?
Like interesting, right? Okay, yeah.
You know, and so I learned that the best way to hand off a problem to solve is say, let's take this mechanic and make the player feel like this with it, right? We're going to take this combat moment, right? And we're going to make them feel this sense of tension, and I can really see what the other enemy is doing and let them read the opponent. That's really the goal. Okay. Well, then that tells you a bunch of stuff about, you know, how fast the combat's going to be and kind of what the motions are going to be. And it gives developers a target to go for.
Yeah.
So I've been through all that. And then of course it levels up when the team gets bigger. You have to produce these big sort of guiding pillars about what each of the factions are. You know, we have these knights, these Vikings, these samurai, but yeah. That's not really what they are. They're not just skins, right? They're like belief systems. These three factions, right? They're like, I discovered this. I would give the test. I would say, ask people, knight, Viking, samurai, right? And everyone always knows, right? That's the amazing thing about that question is, you know,
of course,
right?
Viking, yeah, of course.
Well, you know, yeah. So there you go. And you've known that since you were 8, right?
That's right.
Like,
yeah.
It's, you know, we all do that. Well, why? Because those are values. And if I would say, if I was to lead to the team and say, well, you know, we're doing Vikings because they're cool. Well, all right. But instead I say, we're doing Vikings because Vikings are about the belief that life is meant to be lived to the fullest. And it's about freedom and expression and passion and really, you know, the enthusiasm for what you're doing and fearlessness, right? Like you're the moment of your death has been foretold. So fearlessness, right? Just go for it all the way, like living that way. People who choose Vikings, they believe in that, right? They tend to anyway, right? They tend to have those kinds of beliefs. For people who choose knights, they believe in protecting the weak, right? Like stepping in front, like I am the law, the shield that defends the, right? They say this sort of the concept of nobility. And people who choose samurai, they tend to believe in mastery, right? They choose in like, you know, the studying something, reaching for perfection, knowing that you'll never get there, right? So the trick, what I've learned over the years on this project is instead of telling people what I want, I tell them why I want it.
It's interesting. Like, I remember hearing an interview with Brad Bird, the film director, one time where he said that directing is just a series of responding to yes or no questions. And just anything you can do to like alleviate from that bottleneck is key. So that seems like a good way to go, right?
That's the key. If you can give them a lens, you say you can do that. You can do a yes or no, yes or no, yeah, this. And you have to do that, right?
So what is the final phase of creative directing that you learned on this project then?
Being done and kicking back and playing the game while, you know, all the builds finalized. What's weird about being a creative director, and it's not obvious to people that it would be this way, but it's I'm the first one who's done, right? I'm the first one out the door. And so like, it's a weird experience, right? But normally if I'm doing my job right, I shouldn't be involved in the finaling process very much, right? We should just be fixing bugs and stabilizing, and the game design team is making their balance changes, and you know, we're fixing the game, but everything should be in place, right? So I've actually been, you know, just relaxing, thinking about the future, and you know, just like chilling for a while.
It's
so
gotta be nice.
It's weird. It's not comfortable. I'm not okay with it.
Does chilling involve just sitting back and getting a lot of feedback from the beta, watching Twitch streams, all that type of thing?
I have been involved in a couple of Twitch streams. Yeah, been digging in there, having, you know, playing the game with people, having a great time. It's been amazing. The response has been, it's overwhelming. Honestly, I love how much the fans are really embraced. Feels like they really embrace the system. And my favorite moments are always when I catch people, I see people online, they're talking to each other, or even sometimes live, and they're explaining the game to each other, right? But they explain it in terms of like real combat, right? They're like, you know, no, you need to do this thing, and you step back and use the thing. They're not talking about it mechanically, right? They discuss it in terms of like, you know, the real space as though it was a real fight. And I just love that was always our goal, was for you to believe in it as a fight, as a real fight, right? Without burdening you with all that simulation crap, right?
I think that's the way. I think that's the way Conan O'Brien explained it to Tom Brady recently.
Yeah,
I think that's
about right.
Did you watch that video yet? Have you seen that?
I did. It was amazing. It was so good. I mean, I don't know what Conan was thinking he was going to get from Tom.
It's a real chuckle fest, that guy.
By the results at the end, I don't know that I would be surprised.
So with monitoring the beta and everything, is there a world where you can see the stats? Do people in Asia tend to go for the samurai? Do Scandinavians tend to go for the Vikings? Is there any differentiation there that you can reveal?
Yeah, I mean, there's a little bit of a drift in that way. We see a kind of a... generally a nice even split sort of across the population. Samurai as a whole has a slight bump in popularity. There's like a 30-30-40 split that you see often in the polls.
Okay.
They have good press, right? Samurai have good PR, right? They've had a good, you know,
thousands
of years of good PR is paying off right now, right, mm-hmm. for the samurai. And you do see a little bit more of a leaning towards the home team gets extra love, right? You know, like the further north you get, the more Vikings you see, and you know, but it's not, you know, it's not huge. We see shifts in the population.
So you love hearing people describe the game as actual combat, but is there anything you're looking for in the beta? Any feedback that you're really hungry for? What are you most jonesing for there?
Well, this beta, when we're getting at this point in the game, right, we're always looking for balance issues, and you know, we're getting a lot of feedback on you know, what people are perceiving. And there's always this weird disconnect between what people, you know, the way that they feel about the balance and what the numbers actually tell us.
Yeah,
right?
For
so
sure.
we always have to balance that out. But we're still looking at that. But with the closed beta, of course, really what we're trying to accomplish is we're moving into the phase where we're just testing our infrastructure, right? Like, just, can we hold up this many people, right? Can we keep this damn thing running, and working on matchmaking and you know, just the getting to the scale the game. It's also you know, the first time we have 9 heroes available, right? Which is, you know, just 3 shy of our full set of 12, right? So seeing people, you know, we've sort of been gradually expanding that as we go. So seeing people, you know, seeing the way that players choose their team layouts and what characters they choose when the field of selection is a lot wider, right? Is super interesting, right?
I mean, it certainly looks like you guys were greatly inspired by Rainbow Six Siege. And having the operators there, was that a direct comparison, or is that just a coincidence?
I would say it would be. I think it's 2 teams working in the same, you know, same building who came to the same good conclusion separately is kind of the way that it works. We talk to each other, and of course, Rainbow. What's cool about you working at Ubisoft? One of the things that's cool about you, Ubisoft, is that you get those best practices, right? But I mean, we've been it's been a long project, right? And our problem is very, very different than Siege's problem, right? We're third person, right? We have this sort of the Dominion mode, right? We're really built up by these big battlefields, and they're really about their asymmetric thing, and right, it's a Rainbow's a totally different experience. But it also, what was cool about Rainbow was that it really proved that this approach of, like, we're going to give away, you know, the maps are going to be free, right? We're going to give you free content moving on afterward. We're going to, you know, let you, you know, sort of customize your own guy, and really putting a lot of emphasis on the post-launch content, and being sure that we're doing that in a way that feels fair and equal to the players. That really works when the game is good, right? Like, that's the right way to go. And so it was great to see that. That was our plan all along. Like,
yeah.
It wasn't like, oh, we should do that too. It was like, no, that we thought it was a good idea. And look, it was a good idea, right? Like, so that's been nice. But it's, you know, it's a very different team, very different process.
Yeah.
Anyway.
No, you got it.
So sometimes good, like you want to make good design decisions, and sometimes a good design decision is just good, even if the last team out the door did the same thing, right? And so it's hard to evaluate, you know.
Having towers that you climb up to reveal the map, that's just good. Ubisoft can't get away from it. It's just golden. It's perfect.
Wow, we should add those.
So now that the game's so close to release, are there any big misconceptions out there you want to clear up? Do you hear people saying something about the game a lot that isn't true, that you want to embrace, like have them bracing for more of the game to have an impact in this way?
What I would say is that the biggest thing that I see people saying, that it's not necessarily a bad thing, is that they're really surprised that this is the game. Right?
Huh.
They there's a lot of people who watch the game, like they've seen videos of the game, and they're like, oh, it's a, and they fill in the blank on what they think the game is and go, I know what that feels like.
Dynasty Warriors, got it. Yeah.
Yeah, I know what that is. That's Dynasty Warriors or whatever that is, right? And then they pick up the controller, and then like 5 minutes later, they're back on Reddit going, dude, it was not that. It's not that at all, right? Like so I think the misconception, the one that is, it's always been tricky for us, which is it really is new. Like, new in a way, like, you haven't played a game that feels like this, and you may or may not like it, right? Like, I'm not saying that guarantees you're going to like it, but what I'm saying is, if you've seen the game, or you're hearing about it, and you think you know what it's like, you probably don't, right? So give it a shot, right? Yeah. Like, we've got, you know, open beta coming, right? Like,
right there. You know, just like, play it. Yeah.
Just play it. Just download it. Play it. And that's the, I think that's the biggest one that we try to cross with people, is it's not what you think it is.
Yeah. It's exciting to have a new IP in the industry, especially exciting to have one that feels new coming from a studio as talented as USF Montreal. So it's a fun time for the industry. So, hey, thanks for the hard work, man. We appreciate it.
Well, it is what we're here to do. So I'm glad that it's worked out. I'm super, super excited that you guys are having a good time with it. So
yeah.
Anytime, man.
All right. Awesome. Thanks for your time, Jason. Appreciate it, man.
Take care.
All right. And thank you so much for watching or listening to this episode of the Gameformer Show. Be sure to tune in next Thursday. We'll have a new episode waiting for you. Bye, everybody.
Whatever Meg Ryan sounds like in When Harry Met Sally, I guess.
Oh, diner.
That famous scene.
Oh, diner.
And Billy Crystal's mom turned around and, or not Billy Crystal, I'm sorry, Rob Reiner's mom turned around and said, I'll have that diner.
I hate all of you.
Hey, man.
Diner, more like wiener, she said with a wry smirk. All right, mom, we're going to need another take.
Diner, more like Rob Reiner.
This is a little segment we like to call what Rob Reiner's mom probably tried to improvise during that scene. All right, mom, and take three.
You ready for my Rob Reiner impression? Let me see if I have one.
Wait, you're Rob Reiner's mom? I'm the mom?
I think so. Let's
okay, see. You're Rob Reiner.
Mom, you've got to do better takes!
And then you have to cue me.
All right, and go!
But any JV to make the Meg
Mom!
Ryan. I know that.
We're shooting the movie now.
I know, Rob. I know, but I just need the sound. I need the cue.
I gave you the cue, Ma.
Meg Ryan's on set. She looks like JV Gwaltney. Can she make the sounds?
Who the fuck is JV Gwaltney?
Can she just make the sounds? And then it'll be my cue.
Meg, can you please again in the diner? And stop yelling diner.
I think Cork's curious about what.
Tell me about your father. Wait, I guess it's my husband, Carl Reiner.
Dad was great.
President of video games.
Jesus, get me out of here.